It's 900 hours Central Africa time on this Thursday, the 13th of October 2016. This is Newsroom Jumbo Africa. And a very warm welcome to the first hour. I'm Elvis Presley.
And I'm Renee Vest. We'll be with you until 12 o'clock today. Stay with us as we broadcast live from our Auckland Park studios here in Johannesburg to the rest of the African continent. Now, we're also streaming live on our YouTube channel, if you don't know already. And our entire show is available after this live show, live broadcast. Now, today's focus is on President Jacob Zuma, who has established a ministerial task team to assist Blade Nzimande, the Minister of Higher Education and Training, to normalize the situation at the institutions of higher learning. And now Pravin Gordhan is not part of that newly formed task team.
And that is very surprising, Renee. The finance minister is not involved there because we're talking about fees must fall. But the question we pose to you, it's on your screen right now, a little bit different. So what solutions do you think that the interministerial task team should come up with to deal with this particular issue? That's the question we pose to you. Let us know what's on your mind on the Twitter handle as well as on the Facebook page. You can do so throughout the program, and we'll read your comments as we continue. But first, let's take a look at your news headlines. Protesting students clashed with police at the Vaal University of Technology last night.
An intense search is underway for the awaiting trial prisoner who shot and killed a police officer in the East Rand.
And the man who killed three people at the upmarket Meadows estate at Moroletta Park, east of Pretoria, is dead. Well, those are your headlines, but before we get to the news with Renee, let's find out from Kendall Makamate what's happening on the sports front. Kendall, what a play yesterday by the Proteas.
Absolutely. You know what? That's why I love my job. There is a silver lining in the cloud, I can tell you that. The Proteas did the job, and we didn't expect it, but they have done it. They have actually beaten the top team in ODIs, but once again, I get ahead of myself. Good morning to you. This is what we're having in the sports today.
Got him! Another one!
Imran Tahir's double wicket maiden sparks the blaze that consumes Australia as the Proteas make a clean sweep of the five-match ODI series.
You know our supporters, they want their bragging rights against Pirates and Chiefs. They want the star. I must make sure that the star is there.
Peter Musimane and Mamelodi Sundowns are one step away from continental glory as they prepare to face Egypt's Zamalek in the CAF Champions League this weekend. Tennis, Serbia's Viktor Troicki causes the upset of the Shanghai Masters Tournament, beating Rafael Nadal in straight sets. Now, all this and more I've got for you later on in the sports bulletin. Be sure to stick around for it about 10:40 or so. For now, it's back to Renee, who's got the news.
Thank you, Kendall. Protesting students clashed with police at the Vaal University of Technology last night. Several buildings were damaged, including two that were set alight. The university was also hit by an arson attack a few months ago when officers at residences were set alight by protesting students. The students are demanding an urgent meeting with management to discuss their grievances. No arrests have been made, but police are maintaining a strong presence at the university. Police have fired rubber bullets at striking TUT students this morning. Students gathered from early this morning where they have been singing and chanting. Now, police say the protest is illegal. They have already made several arrests. Meanwhile, it is not clear whether academic activities will resume at the Tshwane University of Technology. Management says the university will remain open and has appealed to students not to let the academic year go to waste. The appeal follows clashes between police and students. TUT says it will also tighten security to ensure the safety of its staff, students and property. Meanwhile, protesting WITS students say they are ready to meet with management this morning. The students agreed to go into talks with management after a mass meeting last night. But they say the meeting will only happen if a mediation process goes according to plan. Students are expected to present internal issues, including the removal of private security and police from campuses. On Tuesday, police confiscated 6 petrol bombs at the main campus. They are still investigating who planted them. Meanwhile, the University of the Western Cape has followed on the heels of the University of Cape Town in deciding to suspend all classes for the remainder of the week. Classes at the Tshwane University of Technology are due to resume today after students clashed with police when they took their FISMAS 4 protests to the Pretoria CBD. Police fired rubber bullets and tear gas to disperse them. In other news, the man who killed 3 people at the Upmarket Meadows estate at Moroletta Park east of Pretoria has died. His body was found by police who stormed the man's house last night. The names of the 4 deceased have not been released. The gunman had earlier freed 2 police officers and 3 security guards who he had held hostage. The trouble began when the man reportedly started throwing stones at residents. He then fired shots from his balcony at police and guards who approached his house to negotiate with him. Police spokesperson David Miller says 3 bodies were found outside the gunman's house.
Members of our special task force, they went through into the suspect's house. They managed to get access into the house itself. During their search of the house, they discovered the body of a deceased male. I can further confirm that outside of the house, we have confirmed that there are 3 further members of the community that are also deceased. That then has to do with the photo that was circulating in social media. So at this stage, we are in a position to be able to confirm, yes, there were other members of the community that are dead as well.
An intensive search is underway for the awaiting trial prisoner who shot and killed a police officer at the Tembisa Magistrates Court in Ekurhuleni yesterday. Joshua Bomba Shongwane was due to appear in court on 9 hijacking cases when he held up 3 police officers, shooting and killing 1 of them before escaping.
It was behind these walls that the drama unfolded, leading to the tragic killing of a police officer. Joshua Bomba Shongwane was due to appear in court on 9 counts of car hijacking. The alleged crimes were committed in the Johannesburg areas of Rabi Ridge and Kagiso.
He was coming from the Johannesburg Correctional Services. Whilst he was inside, he held up 3 officers, took the keys. Whilst he was escaping, he shot the officer and he left the keys there. At this stage, we don't know where he is.
Police describe Shongwane as dangerous.
We are appealing to the members of the public that if they see him, they mustn't confront him, but they can phone the nearest police station or they can phone Crime Stop.
Police have sent their condolences to the captain's family and have appealed for information that could lead to Shongwane's arrest.
Now, the FISMAS 4 student protests have entered their 4th week with no solution in sight. Other universities have opted to suspend the academic program while scrambling to find a lasting solution to save the 2016 academic year. Now, all eyes remain focused on the universities, which mostly is WITS and the University of Cape Town. Now, efforts to resume lectures has become an uphill battle. Students have called for a total shutdown of all institutions of higher learning, and the prospects of losing the 2016 academic year is slowly and surely becoming a reality that South Africans will have to face.
The prospects of losing the 2016 academic year are slowly becoming a reality that students will have to face. This is what triggered the situation.
We have looked at the challenges at hand from all sides and have concluded that the best approach would be to allow universities individually to determine the level of increase that their institutions will require to ensure that they continue to operate effectively and at least maintain existing quality, with the caution that this has to also take into account affordability to students and therefore has to be transparent, reasonable, and related to inflation-linked adjustments. Our recommendation is that the fee adjustment should not go above 8%.
Various efforts to defuse the situation have not yielded positive results. President Jacob Zuma's multi-stakeholders meeting has also not managed to resolve the volatile situation. Since then, government remains mum on a new solution to what is becoming a national crisis. The much-anticipated Vets General Assembly never materialized. Now police have their hands full as the protests have spiraled into the streets.
Essentially, we have said this and we will continue to say that we are very resolute in our stance to say we're demanding free, quality, decolonized education now.
At this point in time, we do not see classes resuming anytime soon. What we want is the management to come down and speak to us and show the support that they've been saying that they're having for us.
Many African people are suffering. We are not doing this for ourselves. We are doing this for our brothers and sisters back at home who are addicted to nyaope because they are hopeless. So we want to restore hope back into our people.
The students are protesting. They protest as if there is no process addressing this matter. And yet there is a process headed by a judge with people with expertise to deal with this matter. Now, they are pushing protests, and their approach is quite a problematic one, because they are not necessarily negotiating. For an example, they ought to go and make a presentation why they say this and give the details. But they, when they speak in public, they say we are not going to stop until our demand is accepted. Now, we don't negotiate like that. Now, that has led to a situation of violent protests, which has seen one life gone in Vets University. And we saw a bus a few days ago being burnt. We saw students fighting with stones. That has become violent. So we have then established this small committee.
Students are not backing down on their demand. They want free education now and are advocating for a total shutdown until government gives in to their demands.
Our single focus has been that we want to save the academic year. We want 27 or 37,000 students to graduate, to pass the year, or to the 5 or 6,000 to graduate. That is our single focus.
We're still emphasizing, as was emphasized at that Imbizo, which you called on Monday, for students to go back to class and say whatever other issues that are outstanding, they can be dealt with through discussions and negotiations.
Universities are for now caught up between a rock and a hard place in a catch-22 situation, as they are in no position to declare free education that has come from the government. Efforts to resuscitate lectures are also not in sight. On the other hand, time is running out, with 2 weeks to go before the end of the 2016 academic year.
Those are your top news stories for this hour. But we are asking you a question of the day. Now, do you think that the ministerial task team that President Jacob Zuma has developed is going to come up with a viable solution for the Fees Must Fall movement? Well, for more on this, let's go over to Elvis.
Well, that's a very important question that we posed to you. We'd like to get your thoughts on the Twitter handle as well as on the Facebook page. But as the protest around the Fees Must Fall campaign intensifies, economists have warned that there could be far-reaching consequences for the South African economy if the 2016 academic year is not saved. A recent report released by Statistics South Africa shows that the unemployment rate slightly decreased to 26.6% in the June quarter of 2016. That's from 26.7%, that means 1% up in the 3 months to March. The number of unemployed fell apparently by 1.6% and employment went down by 0.8%. Meanwhile, there seems to be no end in sight to the current impasse between the students, government, as well as universities on the Fees Must Fall campaign. The situation is likely to add to the already high unemployment rate, as many students will leave universities with no qualification. For some students, it would be a lost opportunity, as they would not even be able to study at the university anymore. The head of Nedbank Strategic Research, Mohammed Nala, now joins us in studio to talk to us about that. A very good morning to you, sir, and welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Mr. Nala, how will this current situation with the student protest affect our South African economy?
Well, that's actually, it sounds like a simple question, but there's so many different facets of impact to the South African economy. So let's maybe break that down into the immediate impact first and foremost. You just need to look at those visuals. International investors see those visuals, and it leaves this negative perception over South Africa, a society that currently is battling with many challenges. And unfortunately, that's the immediate impact. They look at this, they say, do you want to be invested in South Africa relative to other emerging markets? Are there problems any worse or any better? And that informs global investor appetite. But deeper than that, much more important to that, are the lasting impacts on the South African economy. What happens here? What happens on the ground? And I would say, first and foremost, the immediate impact would be to families currently impacted, families of the students that are sitting at these universities. If the academic year is lost, think of it in terms of a household.
Yes.
You're paying X amount of rands every year in terms of university tuition, sometimes boarding fees as well. In the event that this academic year is lost and the student needs to repeat that year, that is a cost of yet another year's worth of funds that you could have directed to other avenues, whether that
maybe is... Maybe a second child, even.
A second child, potentially even other avenues in the economy. I mean, we know that the consumer is currently very hard-pressed. Households are very hard-pressed. We've got consumer spending that has declined. So this, unfortunately, takes out of the pockets of the consumer very directly. But then if we take that and we look at the longer-term knock-on impacts, if you look at the fact that if we lose these students, we effectively lose a full year worth of doctors, a full year worth of nurses, we lose accountants, pick your vocation.
Yes.
Now, if you have a look at how any of these institutions plan, they plan for a certain intake from every academic year to grease the wheels to keep the system going. You bank on a certain number of graduates coming out of the system, and likewise, the universities plan on those graduates moving on so that they can actually take on the next year's worth of graduates. So effectively, you're losing a full year worth of productive capacity for hundreds of thousands of people that could have become economically active participants in the economy.
Now, the million-dollar question that everybody is asking, could South Africa even afford free tertiary education?
Well, again, let's take a step back. South Africa currently is sitting in a very constrained fiscal space. We're going to have the medium-term budget policy statement in about a week and a half's time, and that's going to show you an economy that has run behind in terms of revenue collection because growth has deteriorated.
Yes.
They've potentially run a little bit ahead of their expenditure commitments as well. And so to throw on top of that an additional spending commitment will come with some ramifications. What are those ramifications? Well, effectively, if you want to promise free tertiary education to all, there will be a cost associated, and that cost will have to raise revenue somewhere else. It's going to have to come from additional taxes from somewhere else in the economy. It's going to have to, you're going to take from one pocket to distribute to the other pocket.
Yes.
And this comes in the context of the fact that ratings agencies are watching South Africa very closely in terms of can we stick to a fiscal discipline and avoid a credit ratings downgrade.
Now, a lot of numbers is being thrown around in terms of what would it cost the country, between 40 and even 70 billion rand. Is that the sort of figures that we're looking at, or is it more, perhaps?
So what you have to remember is that this is not a once-off cost. It's not as though you're going to settle this amount and walk away. It becomes a recurring cost. If you promise free tertiary education for all this year, then that persists for as long as that framework exists. And so over the longer term, the cost could balloon to well in excess of those estimates that are put out there.
Yes.
Because remember, at present, this is the existing stock of students that are going to university. If you promise free tertiary education to all, you're likely going to find a whole host of new applicants to university. So this raises questions around capacity at universities. Can they accept these new entrants? And so I would estimate that the longer run costs could possibly even run into the hundreds of billions of rands.
The ministerial task team has just been established by the president to look at fees must fall, but the Treasury Minister of Finance is not included there. What do you make of that?
That is, I mean, that's a very surprising development, simply because Treasury is a pivotal part of the process. We're going to have to find the money or at least some sort of funding mechanism. It need not come directly out of the fiscus or fiscal transfers, but we have to find a funding mechanism to pay for these for any concessions made in terms of the fees. National Treasury would be a pivotal part of that process. So, unfortunately, yes, it does raise a couple of question marks around why National Treasury was not brought into that specific task team.
What about service delivery? And I'm talking broad perspective here now for the entire South Africa. How will that affect in terms of what we currently have?
So at present, you could almost see the fees must fall protest as a venting of some of the anger around service delivery, because I see education as a service that is delivered. You know, and South African tertiary education is currently subsidized by the state, but the knock-on impact as well is, like I mentioned earlier, you're going to have doctors and nurses that were set to go into that service, to go into our hospitals, to help bolster, at least maintain a certain degree of civil service and service delivery, those graduates might not go into the system. And that will further constrain the ability to deliver quality services to the people, which unfortunately compounds the problem of a very fractious socioeconomic backdrop in South Africa.
Parents are concerned, clergy is concerned, they're looking for some divine intervention. But from an economic perspective, what is some of the solutions that we can seek? And do you think there is something that we can look forward to for 2017?
Elvis, it's a very complex problem. Now, what do you do with complex problems is you break them down into smaller, more achievable tasks. Mm-hmm. And right now, I think we're looking at this thing very much from a macro level. We're looking at it from ideological standpoints. I'm sure the negotiating parties right now need to break this down into first component. I mean, Professor Habib has come out and said, we need to save this academic year. Mm-hmm. That is one achievable, one deliverable. The second thing is you need to say, right, what are the sustainable gains that we can put in place, and what is the plan? You don't achieve this overnight. What are the milestones that we're going to set out to achieve over specific time frames? And right now, that plan is something that's still absent, and I think it's absent because the parties still remain on very far and disparate opposite ends of the spectrum right now.
Mr. Nala, thank you so much for your analysis.
Thank you.
That was the head of Nedbank Strategic Research, Muhammad Nala. What do you make of that? And let us know what's on your mind on the question that we posed to you. Do you think that the ministerial task team can do what they're supposed to do and bring conclusion to what we're searching for? And that is solutions. But yesterday we asked you the question, what do you make of the National Prosecuting Authority summoning the Finance Minister, Pravin Gordhan? Let's take a look at what you have to say. This first one coming from This South Africa says, it's a clear indication of the extent of the crisis that we find ourselves in. It's malicious prosecution. The next one came from IH Nazo. He says, I question the delays leading to his arrest with its timing to happen now. At least the court of law and judge will take over. This one from Isolja says, their actions smells of hidden agendas and desperation. They lose again because there is an ill-conceived act here. Well, it seems like some conspiracy theory there. Doc Moses Villani says, let the law take its course. No one is above the law. Let's stop with conspiracy theories. Well, there's another one. Hashtag NPA, hashtag Pravin Gordhan. That's from Doc Moses Villani. Well, there you have it. These are some of your comments. On our picture of the day, it comes from Nomhlihle Ntsikazi, and it is captioned, I will never understand this stage in protesting. Look at that picture there. Hashtag FMF, hashtag Cape Town shutdown, Bellville campus. Look at the fire burning there. So you are fighting for free education to go to university, and then you do that. You burn down your university. Our comment of the day comes from How to Trade South Africa, who says, well, incredible performance from hashtag Proteas, record making beating handed to the Aussies. Well done, we are very proud of you. What a fire, a Protea fire. What a match yesterday, wasn't it? Unbelievable. The first whitewash, by the way, from any country that the Aussies has got, and that's from us. That's fantastic. Now let's take a look at what's happening in the courts today. We start off in Limpopo, where a prominent ANC leader in the Waterberg region in Limpopo was arrested for the alleged rape and bribery, and he is expected to appear in the Mokopane Magistrates Court. The 40-year-old regional leader allegedly raped a 22-year-old woman in the hotel in Mokopane about 6 months ago. Let's move over to the Western Cape, where a 26-year-old student at the Cape Peninsula University of Technology expected to appear in the Bellville Magistrates Court on attempted murder charges. Now, he was arrested after allegedly locking up security guards in a campus building and setting it alight earlier this week. How do you condone that? I would like to find out from you. Still in the Western Cape, a man believed to be the son of a Lutzville farmer on the Cape West Coast has been arrested for the murder of a farm worker. 32-year-old Adam Pieterse was killed on a farm in Lutzville last year. His body was found in a shallow grave neighboring the farm where he had worked The accused is expected to appear in the Lutzville Magistrates Court today on a murder charge. Now, all these stories are available. We'll keep you updated on these cases as they develop, so you have to stay tuned on your favorite channel. This is Channel 404 on DSTV. SABC News, this is Newsroom. Let's take a break.
Yet somehow, living small became the norm. Until we remember how great living big really is. At Macro, we're still big on being big. Big on convenience, experience, range, and savings. Big on the moments that matter. Rediscover how beautiful it is to be big on life.
Information-hungry viewers stay with SABC News as issues on the West are different from issues on the East or here in Johannesburg. So it is not surprising that people who follow the news know that there are two things for sure, that anything can happen, and SABC News will tell you when it does. Because we keep the nation fully informed. We are SABC News.
Welcome back. Now, the future of medical students hang in the balance as the Fees Must Fall protest continues. Final year medical students expected to assist in different hospitals next year would not be able to do so if they do not sit for their end of year examinations. Now, currently, South Africa has a shortage of doctors, and the current situation could also put pressure on the already depressed health systems. Now, efforts are underway to save the 2016 year so that we do not go to waste and secure the future of many students out there. The head of Wits Medical School, Professor Martin Feller, now joins us in studio to talk to us about how the current student protest will impact on medical schools. Professor, very good morning to you and welcome.
Thank you very much, Aldous.
How dire is the situation if we do lose this academic year 2016, especially for medical students?
Well, I mean, losing the academic year would be an absolute disaster. Mm-hmm. And certainly our view is that we need to do everything we can to ensure that we deliver the roughly 1,800 medical students that are going to graduate this year into the work market. Mm-hmm.
We do currently have a shortage of doctors in the country. Will that even make the situation worse?
Well, in the short term, obviously it would. Mm-hmm. But certainly where it will also have an impact is that it will put the pressure on future training certainly into the next year or so. Mm-hmm. And therefore will make a big difference in terms of where we go in future years.
Yeah. Talking about medical students, those that are supposed to finish now in third or fourth year that do not finish, and the new intake that you need to take in for 2017, they won't be able to get in because the university there will be no space. Is that correct?
Well, we certainly have been over many years now trying to maximize the amount of training that and the resources that are available to it. Mm-hmm. Therefore, there will be, if we're not going to get these students out this year, we'll have additional difficulties in the next year in terms of putting them through their clinical training and so on. There is a limited amount of clinical training facility available, mm-hmm. and that would be put under great, great pressure.
And so 1,800 was the number you mentioned earlier?
Yeah, that's across the country. There'll mm-hmm. be 300 coming out of Wits next this year. Mm-hmm. And
those that do not complete this year, is there what sort of future do they face? Do they have to redo the final year?
There will be various options available. What we would do is what we already do in the normal situations, that they would then graduate at a later stage during the year. Mm-hmm. But we normally accommodate a relatively small number in that kind of manner. If this is a very large component, it mm-hmm. would certainly put large pressure on our resources.
Now, if you look at the situation, the introduction of the national health insurance, is that going to affect your operations even further when that comes to play?
Well, the big thing about the NIH is that we're going to have to ensure that we up the number of people that we train. I mean, part of it is that the intention of this whole system is to ensure that there's full access by most individuals, and that does require of the medical schools to increase their training.
Where's the biggest need currently, Professor? Is it in private or in the public sector?
Well, undoubtedly, it's in fact in the public sector, and in particularly in communities that are generally under-resourced and underserved, and in the rural environment. And you know, any way that we're going to be able to ensure that those communities get the service they require is by having more doctors.
What can be done, do you think, from your perspective, to save the 2016 academic year, especially for medical students?
Well, our view is that we will use whatever time there is available during the course of this year still to try and achieve that. And while we obviously understand that it will take enormous efforts on all, we will do that as long as we get back to teaching as we have in the last week. I understand that in some other universities that's still going to be a problem, but I do think that many of them, if not all, will be able to still do with the time available.
Now, TUT yesterday released a sort of an agenda in terms of what they're looking forward to finish the academic year, even though the protests are continuing. From WITS perspective, from the medical school perspective, do you have an agenda as of up until now in terms of when the exams or tests will start and when they will finish?
So we have published a revised program, which will essentially mean that we'll be finishing our program now a week later, and that we have also asked the university that we can do our graduations a week later. Clearly, while the situation is so fluid, those are suggestions and we'll try and work towards those. But as things look on the ground at the moment, I think we're getting there.
Does that suggest that students will be writing on Christmas Day?
If that's what it takes, it will happen.
Professor, any last words for especially medical students around the country?
Well, I'm really certainly can talk around the WITS situation is that we are absolutely committed as a faculty to ensure that this year's final years do achieve the graduation and that we'll be able to put them into the work market next year. That commitment is absolute. We'll do whatever we have to do to achieve that.
If they do not finish the year, and I'm not just talking about WITS students right now, does that mean that we have to import doctors from Cuba again?
No.
No?
I don't think so. It'll mean that there's a delay of a number of weeks, potentially a few months. But what the problem is that there'll be areas in terms of the normal progression of the system that will have some difficulty in getting sorted out.
Will service delivery be impacted from hospitals?
Certainly for a period of time, absolutely.
And what's that time frame that we're looking at?
Well, it depends on when we're able to get those individuals graduated and or at least qualified and get them into their internships.
Professor, thank you so much for joining us here in studio.
Appreciate
that was the head
of
WITS Medical School, Professor Martin Feller, giving us his breakdown of what can happen to medical students out there that's supposed to finish this year and the new crop that's supposed to come in. Well, let's take a look at some of your comments coming through. Tshwane University of Technology Management has appealed to students not to let the academic year go to waste. That appeal follows clashes between police and students who burned tires and barricaded the entrances to two campuses of the Pretoria Institution. Let's take a look at what you had to say about that. This one coming from Kitso says, I wonder if the strike is on today at #TUT. Kitso, watch this space. We're going to keep you updated on that one. Queen Pinky says, I swear I've never been this scared. All the banging of doors and some white powder being poured under the door is just too much. Queen Pinky, she's at the residence there at TUT and being intimidated by students that want to protest and getting students out of their rooms. Marcia Lumbumbo says, we can pass and strike at the same time. They are singing and some are crying. #TUT. I am Tiffy T says, I don't think anyone will go to school today at TUT, except those who want to protest for #Fees2017. Those are some of the pictures, people. Look at that. Those are some of the pictures coming through, protesting students against the police. And look at that, students on top of a police vehicle. and this one being sprayed, I think, here. Or he's trying to kick the police officer. Unbelievable. Look at the hand at the back there, with person with a rock in his hand. Is this what it has come to? The face of our student community in South Africa, currently the police under siege. Now, there you have it. These are some of the scenes coming through. What do you make of all of this? And do you think that the ministerial team that has been tasked to look at the situation can assist? That's the question on your screen right now. You can let us know on your on our Twitter handle at SABC Newsroom, as well as on our Facebook page. But first, let's take a look at what's happening on our Facebook page. In KwaZulu-Natal, the police on Wednesday warned of increased stock theft over the festive season and said that they would intensify police operations. Now, this has become a major concern to us, and we will intensify operations in curbing such crimes by doing more patrols and stop and search duties. And I close quote there from spokesperson Lieutenant Colonel Tulani Zwane. Now, the legal team of the convicted murderer Oscar Pistorius have launched a scathing attack on the state's application to appeal the six-year sentence that was imposed on the fallen Paralympian. And finally, water levels at the Vaal and Orange rivers have dropped to just over 51% and 54% respectively. Now, that's very low. This has had an adverse effect on areas that receive water from these rivers, including the Northern Cape. The province is in the grip of the worst drought since the early 1980s. Now, you have to save water, people. Now, these are some of your stories on our Facebook page, and you can follow us there on our SABC website. Go there and find all the stories you need. But right now, let's take a look at the front pages from the newspapers around the globe. And we start off in Scotland. The Scotsman report that Nicola Sturgeon will call on moderate Conservatives, Labour and the Liberal Democrats to form a coalition with the Scottish National Party to fight against a hard Brexit deal for the UK. Moving to India, the Hindu says that Bharatiya Janata, a party worker K.V. Ramath, was hacked to death in broad daylight at Pinarayi near Talasari in Kerala yesterday, 48 hours after the murder of K. Mohanan at Valankichal near Kuchuparampa. And finally, in Israel, the Jerusalem Post reports UNESCO is slated to vote twice this month on Palestinian-initiated resolutions that ignore Jewish ties, Judaism, the most holy sites there, Jerusalem's Temple Mount, and the Western Wall. Now, those are all your newspapers from around the globe. We'll take a look at the African papers a little bit later, but let's take a break right now, and we'll continue our discussion on the 2016 year, which is probably in jeopardy, and we're going to continue with that discussion after the break.
SABC News on point with news around the world. Live transmissions to keep you informed. When history unfolds, we are there.
At which Clinton and her supporters painted an optimistic portrait of America. Statues of the woman who led the march to the Union Buildings in Pretoria in 1956 have been unveiled against the walls of the State Theatre in Pretoria. Sophie De Bruin, Lillian Ngoy, Helen Joseph and Rahima Musa led 20,000 other women to the Union Buildings against the Dompassers in 1956.
It is for the youth to take the baton that we have already handed over to them.
What has happened to South Africa? Uteni, my postcards.
Stay tuned to News Today at 3 p.m. from Monday to Friday on SABC News.
The primary objective of any student registering for university studies is to ultimately obtain that much-needed qualification. Now, thousands of students are currently affected by the FeesMus Fall protests. are faced with the risk of not sitting for this year's final exams. That has not deterred students from their demand for free tertiary education. For more on this, we are joined from our Port Elizabeth studios by one of the leaders of the Fees Must Fall movements, Nati Dwai. A very good morning and thank you for being with us.
Morning.
Now, this Fees Must Fall movement seems to be gaining a lot of momentum in the last few months, if not few weeks. What has the movement achieved so far?
Well, the movement has somehow put pressure on society, has created awareness regarding the problem of free education. It has mobilized students to acknowledge and be aware that indeed the system that we operate under is not assisting. It seeks to alienate us on the basis of finances. So we have indeed made some good stride in bringing society together. We've seen churches, we've seen parents, we've seen a whole structure of society coming into this play of discussing how can we indeed improve the issue of free education. And we've seen in certain universities that universities have somehow come closer in discussing with the students to say how can we alienate or lessen the pressure or the burden that finances have in terms of a student tuition.
Well, you've certainly have united all the universities, and some of the outcomes of that are not actually very positive, but we'll get to that. But I actually want to ask you, why is this Fees Must Fall movement insisting on free education now? It's almost as if you're insisting that this big financial demand should take place overnight, which in a lot of economies is just not possible.
Yeah, look, I think it is somehow misunderstood. Mm-hmm. What we want a commitment towards free education, to say that government is indeed agreeing with us, to say that free education should be a reality in South Africa. Then obviously from there onwards, we can then discuss to say that what is the roadmap we would implement to realize free education. So the now speaks to the commitment to say that we rather not sit in further commissions which will release reports that speak to the same thing. We need a pronouncement so that indeed as government we are committed, and perhaps a law becomes passed through parliament or whatever form of legitimate acknowledgement for the call for free education.
Now there's been a number of universities that have, their management has been called into a meeting to discuss the way forward within their own institution, and our president now has also created a ministerial task team, and we're still seeing students burning institution infrastructure. Now, how do you verify and justify the students that are burning properties, even though managements are meeting?
Yeah, look, we totally denounce violence and destruction of property. Hence, even at the Nelson Mandela Metropolitan University, our struggle in the past 2 years cannot even account for a single window glass being broken. So we've totally remained peaceful. Mm-hmm. We've totally been committed. We don't associate militancy and also vandalism of property. So I can't necessarily speak on behalf of what's happening across the country, but in terms of what we've been doing at this university, we have not been conducting ourselves in that regard. What we've been doing, we've been having mass meeting with students, we've been meeting management with students collectively, because we were running away from these boardroom type of meetings whereby people are sitting in high floors discussing student issues, whereas the students on the ground don't necessarily have a voice in that regard. So what we've had continuously, I think about 7 of mass meetings whereby management has come to students, students have engaged management, and management has responded. So we have been having those engagements with the management. Fortunately, we also have a management that has been very much responding to us. But in terms of violence, we have no incidents of violence. We don't necessarily believe that violence will necessarily take us forward, because should free education be given, these very same buildings and libraries, lecture halls are the same infrastructure that we will be relying on to use.
Exactly. And how do you feel about, or do you feel that your Fees Must Fall movement has been hijacked in a sense by these criminal elements? And actually giving you a bit of a bad light in recent events?
Well, we must first acknowledge that when Fees Must Fall started, it did not start in the manner that we are seeing now. Mm. However, what we keep on arguing is that the presence of police on campuses changes the atmosphere. It attracts an appetite for violence, because it therefore means that instead of engaging, we rather be shot at or tear gassed or et cetera, et cetera. So I think the issue of violence must be seen in its context. It was never a first point of reference in any struggle of students. It is a result of a militarization of campuses, private securities that are torturing students. So I think we must see it to say that the violence is in effect a response of violence that is being enacted on students to begin with.
Mm-hmm. Now, I believe that the Fees Must Fall movement is hoping for a breakthrough in the next few weeks. But how would you feel if this free education that you're fighting for now only actually gets implemented for perhaps the 16-year-old, 17-year-old high school students, and the students that are marching now lose their academic year? How would you feel?
Sorry, I didn't catch the last part.
I'm asking how you would feel if the fees don't get decreased, or you don't get free education, and it only gets implemented in a few years' time, and you lose the academic year.
Okay. Well, look, you must remember that Fees Must Fall started with the argument of saying also we need a zero fee increment, and that argument is still valid even now in terms of that tuition must not go up. And the argument is also said that if then government is saying it cannot implement free education now, at least there's a commitment we must go towards decreasing fees, meaning fees must be going down until such time that we can have free education. Then on the issue of perhaps it being implemented in years to come, the basis of this struggle is not necessarily a personal one, so that I'm doing it for myself only. Mm. We acknowledge that we can't accept for generations to come to face the similar challenge of having to prove that they are poor and therefore they deserve NSFAS, or having to be excluded from education on the basis of them not having sufficient funds. So this struggle is the struggle for those who are yet to come. Even some of the people that are championing Fees Must Fall are people who don't necessarily have to benefit from free education, but as a matter of principle, they acknowledge that a system that operates under the system that we have currently cannot continue operating as such. So it's not necessarily a struggle for the students of 2016, mm-hmm. but it's a struggle for South African students as a whole, be it a child in preschool, that is a child of mm-hmm. a domestic worker or a policeman. That child must know that struggle is a struggle for them. Hence, even in our engagements, we've been engaging high school students, we've been engaging students in primary school, so that this struggle is not only a struggle about us, but it's a struggle about yourself as well. And therefore, there are also ways in which you can make a voice, so that should the time come whereby you are faced with having to enter university, at least one of the least prior concerns you should have mm-hmm. is your concerns regarding how will you fund your education.
Now, creating this Fees Must Fall movement, this campaign, you obviously do believe that free education is possible in South Africa, but where do you think the money should come from?
Yeah, look, there's also a misunderstanding that we are entirely targeting government, which is not correct. We are also appealing to the private sector, a private sector that is under immense pressure now because it might not be receiving graduates. We are saying to it equally, what are you contributing towards funding education? Because as we sit in our classrooms, we are being prepared to be your future employees. Therefore, you also have a mutual interest in regards to free education. So even our protests and our march have also targeted business chambers. And we're saying business chambers and the private sector as a whole, we know that there are trillions and trillions of rands that lay in your coffers and which you are withholding and you're not spending or investing in this country. At least the first primary investment in any country, be it from government and the private sector, mm-hmm. should be towards education.
Well, thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you very much.
That is Nati Dwai from the Fees Must Fall movement. He's one of the leaders there. And he says that they do not condone the violence. There should be no violence. They did not begin that way. That is what he says there. Well, remember, we are asking you the question today. What do you make of the ministerial task team? Do you think that they'll be able to come up with solutions for the Fees Must Fall movement? You can send us some of your views there. Well, let's go over to Elvis.
Well, Renee, let's find out what the people are saying about that particular question. The interministerial task team, can they come up with solutions? Let's take a look at some of those comments. First one here from Stera that says, it is to bring calm to the current situation in universities and to facilitate a peaceful negotiation among the stakeholders. So says Stera, that is what the task team is supposed to be.
Lizzie reckons, give them free quality and decolonize education and you'll see they will start protesting. Fees must fall.
So says Lizwe. Vuyo says they should come up with a plan that will resume free learning, be it they begging for donations or halving their salaries. That is not the politicians that they should give that up. Yeah. Tom Sanka says, Kendall.
The interministerial task team is not established for the fee dispute, so there's no need for Pravin Gordhan. Interesting. We do need Pravin Gordhan, I'd say. This is about fees. It's about money. It's not just about the security cluster. That's what I believe.
That's a very interesting take, says that we don't need Pravin Gordhan in this particular discussion. The finance minister, which is supposed to provide you that indication.
But anyway.
But some people saying there's lots of money available that we can just splurge it out, Kendall.
It's not about splurging, I believe. Yeah? But no? I think there's a large argument to be had. And I suppose not.
It's a good investment for the country, yeah, but we need to look at the consequences and how do we make sure that we have the money available, because it's not a once-off, it's a continuous thing. Yeah. And I mean, we heard earlier from our economist, between 40 and 70 billion rand, that's the numbers being played around. He says it could even go to hundreds of billions of rands per year. And right now, in this precarious economic position that the country finds itself, a bit difficult, isn't it? But you are here for another issue. We are celebrating today.
Okay, let's celebrate. Let me not talk about fees, because we might just go on forever. Yes, we're celebrating the Proteas, whitewashing the top ODI side in the world. Mm-hmm. Australia beating them 5-0. They got a bagel for their efforts all the way from Australia.
Unbelievable. This is the first time ever
that anybody's ever beaten Australia and whitewashed them like that.
Well, this must just happen to the Springboks and then we'll be over the moon.
100% and Bafana Bafana as well. But what this does, it does all sorts of things for quarters, transformation, all sorts of things. Look at this side. Yeah. I'll leave it for a moment for you to look and see who played in this ODI series. It's mixed, you know, and this is what South Africa is about. And this is where South Africa should be going. And that's exactly where they've been. Andile Phehlukwayo, Imran Tahir, Riley Rousseau, stand up. JP Dumini, take a bow.
JP Dumini, what a comeback. I mean, he was not performing well at all, and all of a sudden, just breakthrough.
Yeah, no, in this particular series, he's come through. He's a little shaky, but he's come through. Faf du Plessis has come through. So definitely something to be proud of from these boys.
Well, Tsetse Munari is also joining us on the other side of the continent. What do you make of that win by the Proteas?
It was absolutely brilliant. I think the whitewash was just the cream on top of the cake and everything, the cherries, everything else that we've been looking for. And hopefully we can just carry through with the Champions Trophy coming up soon. You know, the big game temperament. We need tournaments. That's what I want. So
BFG. With a whitewash like that, we might be seeing rain coming soon.
Yes, speaking of rain, I think it's time to jump into the weather. Yes.
It's over to Tsetse Munari with your weather forecast.
Hi there, welcome from the weather desk. So we're seeing a hot day coming up towards Gauteng, the Northwest Province, as well as over the Northern Cape. Not much rainfall is forecast towards South Africa, except maybe if you're along that east coastal line into KwaZulu-Natal, as well as over some parts of the Eastern Cape Province. So some isolated as well as scattered showers are expected towards the northeastern half. Otherwise, dry and hot weather is expected for the next couple of days. Just take a look at those temperatures. A really hot day for Southern Africa. Windhoek 34, 38 at Gaborone, and in the capital of South Africa at around 32 degrees. Bloemfontein is at 28. Still lovely and cool weather for the Western Cape Province and some parts of the Eastern Cape, with clouds developing from Port Elizabeth right towards East London, as well as over Craddock. And then for all those that are going to be in Upington, expect sunny skies, temperatures for them at 32 degrees. Take a look at the central part of Africa as well, a place where you usually see lots of rainfall expected. It looks like it's going to be just patches of clouds and a bit of rain just towards Cameroon. The rest look like it's going to be quite dry, and it's going to be quite a warm day. Addis Ababa, temperatures slightly increasing to 22 degrees. Do expect showers there. Juba is sitting at 37. Sunny skies for much of the eastern and the central part of that equatorial region. A bit of rain towards Brazzaville, Kinshasa, and towards Libreville, including Yaoundé. But the rest, like I said, are expected to be quite hot. And also for North Africa, no chance of rainfall coming through there. We are expecting partly cloudy skies in small places towards Djibouti, just towards South Sudan, and over the central part, hot and sunny skies. That's the order of the day. Temperatures for Baghdad looking a lot better. 29 is your maximum there. Ariyat is at 38 degrees and sunny skies right across Mecca, jumping over in towards Luxor as well as over Al Jouf. Definitely towards Agadez as well. Do expect sunny conditions there. And North Africa is expected to remain quite hot. Tripoli reaching a maximum of 37 degrees. And then across the arc in towards West Africa, a bit of rain towards Marrakech. You do know we are heading towards COP22 just around the end of the year. And then partly cloudy skies, a bit of showers expected along the coastal parts. Those cities are still expected to be extremely hot, although we are expecting rainfall in some of those areas. Take a look at Niamey at 43 degrees, 37 for Bamako, and rainy weather right across Lagos, Abidjan, as well as over Conakry. That's where I'm going to leave it for the weather for now, but do stay tuned. There should be more later.
This is Trends, of course, your one-stop serving of all that's juicy and trending in the world of entertainment and showbiz. My name, of course, is Refiel Wemuilo.
I'm Dr. Selo Mutaung, and this is our talk.
A very good morning and welcome to Media Monitor. I'm your host, Alicia Jolly.
My name is Dumile Matez.
Kulemule Bati.
My name is Mpo. What time is it? It's question time.
For your daily dose of current affairs, tune in to the SABC News Channel.
When you enter Totot traditional restaurant in Addis Ababa, you are greeted by the smell of locally fried Ethiopian coffee beans. The furniture either has a traditional design or are carved with Ethiopian monuments.
The items used for decoration in these traditional entertainment centers are got from different ethnic regions in Ethiopia, and that gives a customer a purely traditional Ethiopian feeling.
For this establishment, creativity is key, as more than 10 similar places are competing for customers in the city.
This table in our restaurant, we use this thing for wedding, only for wedding ceremony. We do have like six chairs, so most of wedding ceremony celebrate here, because this is based on Guragi culture.
For many, the highlight of the night is the traditional dances. The band that plays here is the restaurant's house band, likewise with the dancers.
Our cultural music is different. It is different rhythms. You can't find our music anywhere in the world. We have different types of tones from our unique instruments. I want to promote our traditional instruments globally even more. It is not promoted as much as we would want to promote it.
Often, the customers are turned into participants in the dance or drama on stage. Foreigners are easily attracted to these joints, but the majority revelers are Ethiopians themselves.
There is some ethnic group here in Ethiopia, some more. I think all of them didn't know each other. They need exchange their culture.
The value of these places is intended to go beyond just entertainment. They are now being seen as living modern museums of Ethiopian culture. Koleto Anjohi in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia.
A conscious move from being a street kid to being a barrister of note.
Keep on praying for me to make a better life.
A creative application of the mind on an essential need, water in wheelbarrow containers.
How about if we were to come up with an idea of an enclosed container that sits on top of the frame of a wheelbarrow?
With the sharing of resources, a boy with Russell Silver syndrome receives medication.
The fact that you just said to me, well, you're covered for next month, that's amazing.
So that's the medication.
For more inspiring stories, stay tuned to Bophelong every Friday.
It's 10:00 hours Central African time. Myself, Elvis Preslin.
And I'm Renee Vest.
No, Kendall Makamata, right here.
We'll be with you until 12 o'clock today. This is Newsroom Jumbo Africa. Now, Renee, we're asking a very important question today to all our viewers out there. As you know, the President, Jacob Zuma, has established a ministerial task team to assist Bladen Zimande, the Minister of Higher Education and Training, to normalize the situation at institutions of higher learning. But Pravin Gordhan is not part of that newly formed task team. So the question of the day?
Yes, we're asking, what solutions do you think the interministerial task team on higher education should come up with?
So here's some of the comments here behind us. Makuya says, nothing will change until you give us what you promise us. When was that promise made? Hashtag fees must fall. Hashtag fees 2017.
I believe it was made in 1994.
Now, in 1994, these were some of the comments made by the African National Congress, we believe. This one from TBG, right?
TBG. And he says, we live in a kleptocratic state and political leaders would rather waste money on luxury cars and private jets instead of education.
Well, there you have it. Private jet is part and parcel of the discussion.
Yeah, my status says, SABC Newsroom, this is to bring calm to the current situation in universities and facilitate peaceful negotiations among stakeholders.
Well, that is what the task team is supposed to do. This is what he says. Lizwe says, give them free quality and decolonize education and you will see. They will stop protesting. Hashtag fees must fall. Well, they want these fees to fall, right?
They do, so, but it is going to take some time. It's not going to happen overnight.
We await your comments on the Twitter handle as well as on the Facebook page. But first, let's take a look at the news headlines. Police have fired stun grenades and rubber bullets at protesting students at the Vaal University of Technology.
An intensive search is underway for the waiting child prisoner who shot and killed a police officer in the East Rand.
And the man who killed three people at the upmarket Meadows estate at Tomorrowletta Park, east of Pretoria, is dead. Now, those are some of your headlines, but before we get to the news, let's find out from Kendall Makamata what's happening on the sports front.
Yeah, good morning to you. Everybody's celebrating what the Proteas have managed to achieve in the last couple of weeks, beating Australia and beating them at their own game, and very well at that. Good morning to you. Good morning to you. This is what we've got for you in the sports today.
Got him! Another one!
Imran Tahir's double wicket maiden sparks the blaze that consumes Australia as the Proteas make a clean sweep of the five-match ODI series.
You know our supporters, they want their bragging rights against Pirates and Chiefs. They want the star. I must make sure that the star is there.
Peter Musimane and Mamelodi Sundowns are one step away from continental glory as they prepare to face Egypt's Zamalek in the CAF Champions League this weekend. Tennis, Serbia's Viktor Troicki causes the upset of the Shanghai Masters tournament, beating Rafael Nadal in straight sets. Now, all this and more we've got for you later on in the Sports Bulletin at about 10:40. I'll also be chatting to Dumisa Makalema to do a review of that fantastic 5-0 that we inflicted on the Aussies. But for now, it's back to Renee, who's got the news.
Thank you, Kendall. Now, it's not yet clear whether academic activities will resume at the Tshwane University of Technology. Management says the university will remain open and has appealed to students not to let the academic year go to waste. The appeal follows clashes between police and students. Now, TUT says it will also tighten security to ensure the safety of its staff, the students and property. Now, our reporter is on the ground. Let's go to Criselda Lewis.
Well, these are live pictures from the Vaal University of Technology, where you can see students are hurling stones at one of the buildings here in Van der Bijl Park. Students have been in running battles with police since this morning. They're also participating in the Fees Must Fall protests. Now, we heard just a little bit earlier on that today's protest also emanates from the sporadic protests that we've seen since May this year. The university says the institution is opened, and basically what happened was that the university had been on recess and had resumed on Monday, but on Tuesday students disciplined for a May protest received sanctions, and about 19 students were identified by an investigation by the university into a May protest, which the university says was illegal. And following that, seven student leaders were expelled. So on Tuesday, what essentially happened was that these students were calling for the reinstatement of these seven student leaders. And we saw clashes just a few minutes ago between the police as well as the students, where police had fired rubber bullets as well as stun grenades. And the continuing battle here at the Vaal University of Technology seems to be intensifying. What we also understand is that 17 students were also arrested following the violence that we saw that began yesterday. We understand that they will appear in court tomorrow. We'll just take you through at this stage. You can see there, just in front of us, the students are now picking up more bricks, and they're targeting those bricks at one of the buildings here at the Vaal University of Technology. See students right here in front of us also now wanting to hurl stones at some of the taxis that are passing here. The motorists are also driving past us. There you go. More rubber bullets being fired. Stay with us live here on SABC News. More rubber bullets. More stones. Well, students continue to hurl stones at the Vaal University of Technology building. And more rubber bullets there. The cars also that are the cars that are passing on this main road here in front of the Vaal University of Technology really are not safe at this point. The car's also being turned back by some of the police there. You can see these stones really being flung directly at the passing cars here. These others also making a U-turn. There's also quite a very strong police presence at the Vaal University of Technology. Since yesterday, 17 students have been arrested following overnight violence. These students are also calling for seven student leaders who were expelled at the university following a protest in May, and are saying they want their leaders to be reinstated. These students are picking up, watch right there, those visuals that you're seeing. And police at this point just really holding back as the students continue with their protest. Just a bit earlier on, just before we came on air, there had been a standoff between police and these students where rubber bullets and tear gas, I beg your pardon, rubber bullets and some stun grenades were fired. And what's essentially happening is that there are different groups of these students. They've gathered in different places, so it's making it extremely difficult for police to really follow one group as the different groups emerge from the different directions. There are some of the bins here on the street that have also been... one of the Nyalas I see now charging towards this direction. We'll ask our camera person just to come this way. The police Nyala now perhaps going to charge towards this direction. They have been chasing these students since very early this morning. There you have it. The police Nyala there. Going to give chase to these students, and we'll clearly need to move to one of the other directions as the students are now dispersed and keep running in the different directions. But a bit earlier on, we did speak to the acting deputy vice chancellor of the Vaal University of Technology, and let's take a look now at what he had to say.
Students are coming in. It's just that, you know, with a little bit of uncertainty, they are, you know, trickling in. But officially, we opened. We are operating. We just have to. It's a pity that we couldn't continue with academic catch-up as planned because of this 3-day disruptions. But it's still our intention to engage students. We plan an engagement meeting tomorrow with student organizations because. That's what we're left with, to see whether they are countenancing a situation where the academic year could be lost simply because of a few students that are, you know, real leaders in this whole thing. We are having a heavy police presence. We've beefed up our private security services. So we will try and protect. So far, I'm happy that staff, students and property have been protected. We haven't had extensive damage as we have seen in other institutions. But we are not unscathed because, you know, of the little burnings that happened last night.
This is the second arson attack in a space of like 3-4 months.
Correct.
This must be concerning. I mean, are you somehow even considering shutting down completely for the year?
That would be the very, very last resort. We don't want to miss the academic year. It has serious consequences for the country, for the university, for parents, for donors. So we don't want to be pushed into that corner. That's why we're hanging on there. That's why we're engaging student leaders tomorrow, because the majority of the SRC members are affected by these disciplinary processes. We open up the engagement to student organization leaders. The meeting is taking place tomorrow. Our hope is that out of that engagement, like we did in May, something positive will emerge.
Yes. Well, what you can see here is just some of the remnants of some of the chaos that took place here last night as students were protesting. And let's hear now from one of the leaders of the EFF Student Command, who's been embarking on this action since last night. Sir, I think let's start with what the major concerns are at the Vaal University of Technology. We also understand that there are quite a number of internal matters that you want to address with management.
Yeah, no, we are in support of the National Call of the Free Quality Education. So internally, we've got our own issues. We said that the current fees, we cannot pay them. So we are saying that the next year, January, we need free registration. We submitted the memorandum to the management. The management didn't come to us to actually engage with us. So instead of coming to us to engage with us, they evicted us to from the residence. It was 2 weeks back. So they said that we must come here on the 10th of October to come as if it must be business as usual. So on Monday, we embarked on a strike to say that, but it cannot be correct that you are saying that it must be business as usual. While we've got our own issues, let us come and engage our own issues. What they did, they paralyzed our SRC, Student Representative Council. As we speak, we are leaderless. This revolution is leaderless, that's why it resulted in this anarchy.
Now, we understand yesterday one of the maintenance buildings.
Yeah.
There you have... Well, we'll just continue with this interview. We understand yesterday that one of the maintenance buildings was burnt. There's damage to infrastructure and a number of other things. This protest seems to have turned violent. Is it you as students who are torching infrastructure at the university?
Yeah, thank you very much. That building, it was burnt by the management. The management, because they are entrepreneurs, they are money-driven. They are the ones who send the people there to actually burn our buildings. And I've made it very clear that an unlit revolution... It will.
So you're denying students torched the building yesterday?
Students didn't do anything.
No, who said
I made it very clear that they paralyzed, they expelled the SRC. Mm. So if ever they didn't expel the SRC, this revolution were going to be led and it was not going to result in anarchy. Mm. Yeah.
We understand that this also erupted after the university had come back from recess following the expulsion.
Yeah.
We understand from management 7 SRC leaders.
Yeah.
So you're calling for the reinstatement, but the university is saying that the march or the protest that they embarked on in May was an illegal gathering and they had obtained an interdict against the protesters from embarking on that action. What is your response to that?
No, you know, management of this institution... Hey, they think that we are a subject to their existence, not the other way around. So, yes, of course, at May or on May, we embarked on a strike. But there was no strike that was illegal at anyway. So, instead of coming to us, engage us, they are suspending our leaders. You see? Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much for your time there. Well, it certainly seems that students are going to continue with their action here. It's quite a number of issues that these students are raising here at the Vaal University of Technology. Amongst them, as I mentioned a bit earlier, was, of course, relating to the expulsion of 7 members of the student leadership and quite an array of other issues. We also understand there have been issues relating to a trust fund where... The students say there was a trust fund that was set up to assist a number of students, and they don't know where the money has gone. You see there, students now flinging stones again at the Vaal University of Technology building. Some students standing there on the stairs. And really, no police around at this point. The Nyala that had initially been here. The Nyala that had initially been here to try and disperse these students is now, I think, coming towards this direction. I really cannot see it from the direction where I'm standing at this point, but the standoff certainly continues. Quite a number of issues, including the call for free education now and some internal issues at the institution. But in the majority, we know that this protest started after the university had come back from recess. That was on Monday, and that was when leaders of the student movement had received expulsion letters from the institution, and that is what essentially led to the protests that we're seeing at the Vaal University of Technology. So quite a number of issues that I guess need to be addressed by this institution, but the it seems the running battles are going to continue at this stage as students continue to fling stones. As you can see, their live visuals outside one of the buildings here at the Vaal University of Technology. We'll certainly bring you more from what's taking place here, but students say they will continue with their action. Back to you in studio.
Well, thank you very much, Chrysalda. There you can see those live visuals coming in. That's taking place there at the Vaal University of Technology right now. Meanwhile, protesting VITS students say they are ready to meet with management this morning. The students agreed to go into talks with management after a mass meeting last night. But they say the meeting will only happen if a mediation process goes according to plan. Now, students are expected to present internal issues, including the removal of private security and police from campuses. On Tuesday, police confiscated 6 petrol bombs at the main campus. They are still investigating who planted them there. Meanwhile, the University of Western Cape has followed on the heels of the University of Cape Town in deciding to suspend all classes for the remainder of the week. Classes at the Tshwane University of Technology are due to resume today after students clashed with police when they took their fees must fall protest to the Pretoria CBD. Now, police fired rubber bullets and tear gas to disperse them. In other news, the man who killed 3 people at the Upmarket Meadows estate in Moroletta Park, east of Pretoria, has died. His body was found by police who stormed the man's house last night. The names of the 4 deceased have not been released. The gunman had earlier freed 2 police officers and 3 security guards who he had held hostage. The trouble began when the man reportedly started throwing stones at residents. He then fired shots from his balcony at police and guards who approached his house to negotiate with him. Police spokesperson David Miller says 3 bodies were found outside the gunman's house.
Members of our special task force, they went through into the suspect's house. They managed to get access into the house itself. During their search of the house, they discovered the body of a deceased male. I can further confirm that outside of the house, we have confirmed that there are 3 further members of the community that are also deceased. That then has to do with the photo that was circulating in social media. So at this stage, we are in a position to be able to confirm, yes, there were other members of the community that are dead as well.
An intensive search is underway for the awaiting trial prisoner who shot and killed a police officer at the Tembisa Magistrates Court in Ekurhuleni yesterday. Joshua Bomba Shongwane was due to appear in court on 9 hijacking cases when he held up 3 police officers, shooting and killing one of them before escaping.
It was behind these walls that the drama unfolded, leading to the tragic killing of a police officer. Joshua Bomba Shongwane was due to appear in court on 9 counts of car hijacking. The alleged crimes were committed in the Johannesburg areas of Rabi Ridge and Kagiso.
He was coming from the Johannesburg Correctional Services. Whilst he was inside, he held up 3 officers, took the keys. Whilst he was escaping, he shot the officer and he left the keys there. At this stage, we don't know where he is.
Police describe Shongwane as dangerous.
We are appealing to the members of the public that if they see him, they mustn't confront him, but they can phone the nearest police station or they can phone Crime Stop.
Police have sent their condolences to the captain's family and have appealed for information that could lead to Shongwane's arrest.
Now that is the top news for this hour, and we will be keeping a close eye on what's happening there at the Vaal University of Technology. Now we're also asking you the question of today. We want to know what you think, and should we have a solution, or what are your solutions to the ministerial task team? What do you think is going to come out of that ministerial task team there? Well, to continue with other discussions of the day, let's go over to Elvis.
Yes, Renee, let's continue that discussion. Our recent report released by Statistics South Africa shows that the unemployment rate slightly decreased to 26.6% in the June quarter of 2016 from 26.7% in the 3 months to March. But this is still making the job market increasingly competitive. Graduates from tertiary qualifications or tertiary institutions struggle to find employment. And according to a market leader background screening company, Manage Integrity Evaluation, recent student protest may have a negative impact on the already elevated rate of qualifications in South Africa. Now, the company is concerned that the likelihood of those who fail their respective courses would be turning to qualification fraud to secure unemployment, or to secure employment, rather. Spokesperson for Manage Integrity Evaluation Company, Jennifer Barkhuizen, now joins us from our Pretoria studios. Jennifer, very good morning to you and welcome.
Good morning and thank you for having me.
Thank you, Jennifer. First and foremost, tell us, how rife is qualification fraud in South Africa?
Yes, qualification fraud has really been an issue within South Africa over the last 5 years. According to MIE statistics, we've seen a 200% increase in qualification fraud. Now, this I also believe goes hand in hand with the increase in regards to more and more companies relying on doing thorough background screening on candidates they wish to employ.
And what are some of the reasons for this increase of 200% in qualification fraud?
Well, there's actually many reasons when it comes to why people go to the extent of committing fraud when it comes to their qualifications. Now, you just mentioned the unemployment, and we believe that is a very big part of why people are committing fraud, because they are desperate. They want to find employment and they might have not gotten the desired results they wished for, and they might turn to qualification fraud. Then there's also, you know, the younger generation, they might want to climb the corporate ladder quicker than, you know, wait to gain the experience they need. And then, you know, the older generation, they might have not had the opportunity to study, and then they might turn to qualification fraud.
Now, where does your organization fit into the scenario?
Well, MIE is a background screening company, so we do various checks on pre- and post-employment for public and private companies. So they would come to MIE and we will then verify whatever credentials are asked. Now, when it comes to specifically qualifications, we go directly to the source. So we would go to the institution where these candidates would obtain their qualification, and then we would basically give the results. And to point out, in 2015, MIE conducted over 478,000 qualification checks, and out of those, 15% were found to be fraudulent. And up until June of 2016, we have done over 300,000 qualification checks, and it stayed constant at 15%.
My goodness. But now, the student protest, how is that likely to impact on the increase of qualification fraud?
Well, I mean, with regards to the current protest happening, I mean, there's many reasons for students to turn to qualification fraud. Now, the main one we believe is students are now missing out on very important lectures, and, you know, in preparation for their final exams for 2016, this is a very crucial time for students, and missing out on these crucial lectures and, you know, time to study, they might not get the desired results that they want to, you know, finish off their studies, and then might turn to qualification fraud, or not even turn to qualification fraud as such, but, you know, embellish their results or lie on their CVs. And this is all, it's an act of fraud. So, you know, from MIE's perspective, we urge candidates not to lie or to commit fraud, because you will be caught out. As I mentioned earlier, people in organizations are using background screening services to vet candidates that they wish to employ.
Mm-hmm. So what would be your advice to a student that has now finished his third year but did not complete the exams, and he's now looking for employment, but the only way that he can get that particular job is to say that I have a degree? What would be your advice in that instance?
Well, it's quite difficult having an opinion with regards to that, because I mean it's so different for many students at all, you know, across all the universities. But I will reiterate that it is not worth it lying about a qualification, because it is, as I mentioned earlier, you know, it's act of fraud and that is a criminal offence. If you are caught out, then you would sit with that criminal record for the rest of your life, and it will make it more difficult for you to find employment rather than just to finish your study, even if it does take you longer, because a criminal record will stay with you and it will be in a moment of desperation where you will go and say, okay, I've got this degree, where in fact you don't. So again, I will reiterate, do not lie, do not embellish your qualifications. I mean, I'm really hoping that the students of 2016 will get the opportunity to finish their academic year and, you know, get the desired results that they wish.
My grandmother used to say, my child, the truth will set you free. So rather tell the truth and say I didn't complete because of the protest, and then continue and see if you can finish it the following year.
Most definitely, most definitely.
Now, what should organizations be on the lookout for, especially coming in the new year 2017, when checking for candidates' qualifications, or do they contact you?
Well, yeah, most companies will contact us, you know, to do these various background checks on these candidates. So, and, you know, another note to the students, with everything that is happening, the companies will now rely on background screening services even more because of what has been happening. So they will not know, you know, a certificate handed to you is not proof that that certificate is valid. There is sophisticated technology within the market where people can, you know, create their own qualifications. So it is really important that companies also be very diligent with regards to background screening, checking the candidate, checking their qualification, as well as their CVs, and not taking it at face value.
Thank you so much. That was the spokesperson of Manage Integrity Evaluation Company, Jennifer Barcase, and joining us from Pretoria Studios. Thank you so much for joining us, Jennifer. But the question, of course, we pose to you is, of course, what do you make of new panel that is put together by the President Jacob Zuma? And what solutions do you think that the Interministerial Task Team will have on higher education, and that they should come up with some of those solutions? You can let us know on the Twitter handle as well as on the Facebook page. If there's any of those comments coming through, we'll read them as soon as possible. Right now, let's take a break and we'll be right back after that.
One of the 22 high burden countries, and out of that we're number 6, following countries like India, China, and with huge population.
Cough, night sweats, weight loss, and fever, and cough being the most important of those. So, and especially if the cough lasts for more than 3 weeks, then you really have to worry and get tested for TB.
The motivation is to affect behavior change, particularly with people who cough and who may be carrying the bacterium. So encouraging people to use the elbow.
For more on health, join your host Dr. Selo Mudaung every Saturday from 9 to 10 a.m.
As student protests continue, let's go back to our reporter on the scene, Griselda Lewis, in the Vaal. Griselda, what is currently happening there?
No, Tala, there's nothing to say here, no.
Well, Griselda, can you hear me? Well, it seems like Griselda is not, she can't hear the audio from that side.
Well, just a few minutes ago, here in front of one of... the main buildings at the Vaal University of Technology. Motorists were driving on this road that you can see here in front of us. The protesting students have been stoning vehicles. Unfortunately, all of that took place just before you came to us. There's still quite a large police presence here at the Vaal University of Technology. And protesting students have now been dispersed by a number of police nyalas that is patrolling this area. As students go on the rampage, you can see there on that building, some of these students, you heard a bit earlier on from the management at the institution indicating that some of the lectures are going ahead as planned, but there have been a few disruptions. You can see there, those are some of the students that are attending those lectures, but just outside the premises of the university, the protest actions continue. Police are continuing to monitor the situation here. A number of cars just before we came to air had been damaged as the protesting students were flinging stones at passing vehicles, and really scenes that were extremely volatile at this point. Students are also gathering in several parts around this particular area, but we'll certainly bring you more as the protest continues here. Police are still trying to ensure that the situation does return to normal at this stage, but a lot of the traffic also police are trying to redirect from this area, but some cars are obviously passing the barricade of the police at this stage. We'll continue to monitor the situation from here.
That's Griselda Lewis coming to us live from the Vaal University of Technology there, giving us the latest scenes. As you can see, students throwing stones at the building, and there's other students inside. And we'll keep you updated on the progress here. We'll keep on monitoring the situation there, as well as in other universities around the country, and we'll bring you the latest there.
No discussion about investment in South Africa can be complete without talking about gold. Now, IBV Gold, or the International Banking Vault, it's their business to trade in gold and to look after gold. A little earlier, I spoke to the CEO, Mr. Ashok Sonarang. Tell me a little bit about IBV and the business that you're doing, and the kind of discussions that you've been having here with different stakeholders.
Primarily, our business is IBV International Vaults, which is a world-class safe deposit facility that's in South Africa, in Durban and Johannesburg. And we are now growing our vault business to Zurich, London and Dubai. So the business plan is to grow the brand IBV International Vaults globally, and to take with that our associate brands, which is IBV Gold. It is important for clients who are with IBV International Vaults to have the service of buying gold from IBV Gold, which is a core investment category amongst the other investment classes that are available in South Africa and globally.
As a business owner, talk to me a little bit about the difference that you've seen in your business, but also in other business, that BRICS is made in bilateral trade and opening other avenues for South African business.
Well, Brazil, Russia, India and China are large and growing markets, and to position South Africa within these countries is a great opportunity to network, to interact, to exchange ideas, and to create business links. It is so important on a global platform. So BRICS, with the association of South Africa, Brazil, India, China, is creating a business network, which is so important for us all.
I'd like to personalize it a little bit before we wrap it up. Of course, I know that you yourself are heavily involved in charity back home in South Africa. You feed thousands upon thousands of orphans. That kind of social responsibility, it's very much part of the brand that you've developed. But tell me about the work that you do there.
Well, it is indeed our passion to help the underprivileged and the less privileged. So our social responsibilities as IBV International Vaults is to ensure that we give back as much as we possibly can to our community. And in that regard, we've created a few events like the IBV Children's VIP Day, and we are the proud holder, Guinness World Record holder, for the IBV Supercar Club to raise R1 million in an hour, to have 211 supercars give our orphan children a ride of a lifetime in the supercars for a 45-minute run. So we like to think we're innovative. We want to invite as many social entrepreneurs to participate and be part of the grand plan of each businessman leaving a legacy to the community, and more so to the underprivileged children.
In conclusion, just to wrap it up quickly, do you think in the world of big business that we're in today, there is enough of a focus on the social responsibility aspect of business?
I personally don't think so, because I believe that there is enough money in the world of business, big and small business, for us not to have any social problems of poverty, of child protection. It is sad that governments and business at large are not doing enough. And I think the call to action, the call of sense of responsibility, the call of humanity has to be louder and stronger forever.
Mr. Sonoran, thank you for joining us here in studio today. Of course, it is the second day of the BRICS Trade Fair here in New Delhi. Mr. Ashok Sonoran is the CEO of IBV, that's International Bank Vaults, and of course they play in a space that's very familiar not just to South Africans but to the world at large.
People with prostheses can live normal life.
Prosthetist actually manufactures the artificial limbs.
I can pick up stuff. My friends think it's awesome.
I like my real life.
I can walk normally. There's nothing that I can do. It changed my life from the beginning to where I am now.
Dystrophic dysplasia is a type of dwarfism that affected all my major limbs.
Join Health Talk every Saturday for all your health news.
Good morning, welcome back. I'm Kendall Makhamati, and I've got some very happy news for South African sports fans. Our cricket team claimed an historic 5-0 whitewash against Australia in the one-day international series, played in five cities across the country. The curtain came down in style on a memorable ODI series for the Faf du Plessis-led troops in Cape Town on Wednesday. But the number one ranked ODI team did not go down without a fight.
Funnel down in the five-match ODI series, Australia went into the final match looking to finish the 12th South Africa on the high. While the hosts were looking to further take advantage of Australia's inexperience, bowling attack and wrap up the series in style. South African skipper Faf du Plessis won the toss and sent the Aussies to field first. The Proteas opening partnership of Hashim Amla and Quinton de Kock got off to a promising start, yielding 31 runs after 5 overs at a run rate of more than 6 per over.
No doubt about that.
However, that was before the Aussies dismissed the South Africans opening batsmen in quick succession. Despite losing 2 early wickets after 10 overs, the Proteas were well placed on 52 for 2. However, the man responsible for Amla's dismissal, Joe Manny, struck again, removing skipper Faf du Plessis to leave the home side in a spot of bother on 52 for 3 after 11 overs. Raleigh Rousseau and JP Dominis 178-run partnership for the fourth wicket steadied the home side's innings. Manny was at it again, claiming Australia's fourth wicket and instead dismissing Dominis for 73 of 74 deliveries.
Plays an attacking shot, caught at point.
Rousseau topped the score with 122 from 118 balls, 10 runs short of his career best of 132.
100 up for Riley Rousseau, third time in the series.
The Proteas ended their innings on 327 for the loss of 8 wickets. Joseph Mohali, SABC News.
And it would be amiss of me to actually be done with this bulletin without going through some analysis of it. Dumisa Makalim, a cricket analyst, joins us to wrap the fantastic series and historic result. Good morning. Thank you very much for coming back to Newsroom.
It's a pleasure, Kendall.
Dumisa, one of the things that that really we need to talk about is like this is something to celebrate, something for us to put on the pedestal, isn't it?
Of course. I mean, we come a long way as African cricket. You know, where we're rebuilding most of last year, 2 years back. But now it looks like we've got a solid team, you know, that can compete at world cricket. We've just knocked off, the number one ranked team in the world, you know, 5-0 down. So we can take a lot of positives going to the Test Series next month.
And it does wonders for transformation, because this would not be looking, this team would not be looking like this, I can certainly say, were it not for the drive for transformation.
Absolutely. There are a couple of boys on the right track. You know, the Andile Phehlukwayo is on the right track. Aaron Pangiso has been there for quite a while.
Can I stop you there? Can you say Phehlukwayo again so other people who haven't heard it say it properly can hear it?
Andile Phehlukwayo.
Thank you very much.
It's a very strong surname.
Yeah, but needs to be gotten right.
Yeah, no, so the guys are on a good track. You know, it's very good to see that they are actually given chances and they're actually performing, you know, on that stage, which is good to see, I mean, for the country and for everyone.
Right, now let's look at some of the key players in this. Imran Tahir was absolutely imperious. He did extremely well. Comes in his first over, stops the run chase that the Australians were on. They seem to be particularly ready to take us on after Riley Rousseau's knock, because he was fantastic as well.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think we spoke earlier. I mean, earlier in our analysis, I think about the first or the second game about Imran Tahir and what kind of an impact he's always going to have. He's one of those guys who comes in and he breaks partnerships because he spins it both ways. It's difficult for him to pick, you know. So every time he comes on, something does happen. You know, I mean, speaking of Riley Rousseau, he's missed, 1 or 2 games due to injury. But he's just proved to be one of those guys that you cannot afford to leave him out of the one-day setup anymore.
Quick question. This guy should really be playing at the top of the order.
Riley Rousseau?
Yeah.
It's a touch and go. Where is he going to play there? Hashim Amla averages 51. Just because he's had 1 or 2 bad patches, he just cannot afford to disrespect.
Put Hashim 3. He's played at 3 before.
And then when AB comes back, where does AB go?
Goes to 4.
Well, that's a good headache to have for the selectors. That's exactly. Depth. That's wonderful to have. But he's one of those players that you cannot afford to leave him out right now. He's in such a man of the series. He's played 3 games. So it's wonderful to see for the selectors and for everyone out there.
Now, we're going to see a little bit about how Imran Tahir came on and literally got himself a double wicket made in his very first over that he came on. And literally, he did halt the Aussies. He put doubt in their minds. And all of a sudden, the game changed on his head.
Absolutely. I mean, I was actually watching that. I think the first ball he bowled was a flipper, which Aaron French actually didn't spot at all. But he bowls wicket to wicket. So you either miss and he hits. And I mean, Steve Smith, he plays like that. But when Imran Tahir is on song, it's very difficult for him to actually pick early on in your innings.
Right. Now, you prepared a little bit of a rap for us, just to get into what happened over the series. Shall we get into that?
Yeah, no, we can, definitely. I mean, we're better than the Aussies in a couple of aspects, you know. I mean, we always emphasized about, you know, Imran Tahir and our bowlers bowling wicket to wicket. And more times than not, the Aussies have always found a way to give themselves room, either moving outside leg stump, because we simply were on spot on with our lengths and with our lines. You know, Steve Smith, they're giving himself a lot of room, but, you know, change of pace from Dale Steyn, which means, you know, you have to slow your game a little bit down. As we can see there, you know, the two fingers which are rolling across slows it down. He was on 107 odd, I mean, when he went out there. So a good change in pace. And, of course, Kagiso Rabada at the death with his pace, extra pace, is always going to be deadly, you know, which is good for us. And, I mean, the fourth one day wasn't any different. I mean, Carl Abbott came in after sitting down, you know, on the side for a couple of games. And he cleaned out, you know, the top order, which is so strong, you know, for the Aussies. So it's been very difficult for the Aussies to actually get back from that loss at Kingsmead to actually come back up to win at in Port Elizabeth.
Yeah. Now I see that you've actually got some notes that you've given us as well in terms of what was going on with how these the Aussies were gotten out.
Yes, I mean, I think most of the time they didn't pick our guys, especially Shamsi. Shamsi has played a couple of games. He's played the West Indies. Clearly, it was difficult for them to pick because they kept on playing down the wrong line all the time. You know, as you can see, he spins it into the right-hander, you know, and he spins it away from the left-hander. So he's kind of a bit tricky. So he's a good player to actually have when Imran Taye has been rested because he's that tricky spinner who's a Chinaman. And when, you know, you get guys like Caleb coming back in the middle of the innings and being able to wrap up, a good opening performance, it's always good to see. So it was always very difficult for the Aussies to kick on once they were on the back foot.
Would you say this was a good captaincy by Faf du Plessis in terms of how he mixed and matched his bowlers, or was it really he got the right selection of bowlers to work with?
Listen, I think depth is very important right now, and I think that's what we have. You know, Caleb has played a couple of test matches. He's showed up in a couple of one-day games. He comes back after he's sat down, cleans up, you know, the top order with ease. Shamsi comes in and does exactly that when he's been rested. So we are in good hands. Aaron Pangiso is a very good finisher at the end. But they were always going to be on the back foot when it came the fifth one day. There was no doubt that in my mind that they were going to lose 5-0. And this was just about to, you know, it was just around the corner for them to happen.
Why is that, though? Because the wicket didn't seem to be doing much for the Australian bowlers when we went out to bat.
You know, I think that the biggest difference between these two teams for me is that South Africa basically were clinical in their bowling, and their batting. Australia were not clinical in both. They sometimes batted well, but their bowling always lagged. But you must always remember that we were bowling against a very experienced Australian top order. Mm-hmm. And we've had Dwayne Pretorius come in, who's been experienced. We've had Petruguayo come in, who's been experienced. And most times than not, we've been able to bowl Australia out. They haven't been able to actually do that. That's been the biggest difference. And our fielding has been way better besides yesterday's game, which were very appalling.
Compared to drop catches.
But throughout the series, we've been way better. We've taken catches at crucial times. They've dropped catches at crucial times. So that's been one of the biggest differences.
The one thing that seemed to stick in my mind was how Rabada cut a frustrated figure at times. What was going on there?
You know, he was South Africa's player of the year last season. So a lot of people are going to sit down and they're going to play against him and analyze him through his work, his weaknesses and strengths, his first spells and his last spell. So you are going to get at that stage where he's going to have to think a little bit more, outsmart the person a little bit more, because players are going to sit behind the computer and they're going to analyze in detail. It was very frustrating for him to actually sit out in Port Elizabeth when I felt as if he should have come on, because he's a confidence bowler. He wants to keep on bowling, especially when he went for 80-plus in Durban. So he was not happy about that. But, you know, his class will always show. You know, he's a quality bowler. He works hard. He always put in those yards. Yep. And it's with speed.
Right. Now, coming up, first up, we've got a test series out in Australia. They're definitely smarting. They're going to be trying to put us to the test. And also, we've got the Champions Trophy next year. Quickly, your thoughts on those two in a minute or less?
Listen, South Africa is in very good shape at the moment in terms of their one-day cricket. That's going to infiltrate their test cricket, so that's going to be very good for us. It was very important for us to win this last game, which takes the momentum there. Australia are down and out. They are battered. They've got a lot of work to do. They lost a bad test series in Sri Lanka. They've just lost a bad one-day series here in South Africa. So they've got a lot of thinking to do, and this is less than 3 weeks to go. So they're on the back foot. Champions Trophy next year, I'm looking forward to it. Because we were in good shape as a South African cricket side.
It's about time, man. Last time we got it was 98 or something like that, wasn't it?
It was a very long time ago.
Yeah, I know. It's time for us to get trophies in our cabinet.
Absolutely,
now.
Absolutely.
Dumisa Makalima, thank you very much. Much appreciated. Your input and analysis, incredibly valuable.
It's always a pleasure, Kendall. Thank you very much.
There you have it. Dumisa Makalima from BC Cricket Analysis talking to us about the five-match ODI series. Whitewash, the bagel we gave Australia. We take a quick look at the weather and then we'll be back at the top of the hour with more news.
The Kalahari Transportier Park is a large wildlife preserve and conservation area in southern Africa. Kalahari means place of thirst. The total area is 38,000 square kilometers. Approximately three quarters of the park lie in Botswana and one quarter in South Africa. South Africa embraced the concept of transportiers linking ecological reserves across national borders. On the 12th of May 2000, President Festus Mogae of Botswana and Thabo Mbeki of South Africa formally launched South Africa's first peace park. It has 200 species of birds, including vultures, mammalians such as black Kalahari lions, and large herds of herbivores, namely eland, springboks, blue wildebeest, and more.
Up until our demands are met.
We will continue to fight for free decolonized education.
Absolutely volatile at this stage. Police standing on the one end and the students standing on the other. Can we get some help? Can we get some help?
We want to know why they are shooting at us when we remained peaceful.
We didn't provoke anyone.
All of them have children and families who can't get into university because fees are expensive.
There is no reason to create our universities into police states. There's just no reason, and we cannot.
A presumed U.S. drone strike in the south of the country has killed three Al-Qaeda suspects.
Death toll in Yemen's 18-month-old civil war now stands at about 10,000.
People get killed or die and are actually buried before they're recorded. And we don't have a way of recording that, but we know the numbers are much higher.
Water restrictions are to be imposed on villages in and around the Ngomazi municipality.
Pumps can't pump the water because there's no water in the river. And if the water is coming back, then it's full of mud.
Those who can pray and those who can do any miracle to make sure that we've got enough rain, give it a try.
So people with prostheses can live normal life.
Prosthetist actually manufactures the artificial limbs.
I can pick up stuff. My friends think it's awesome.
I like my real life.
I can walk normally. There's nothing that I can do. It changed my life from the beginning to where I am now.
Dystrophic dysplasia is a type of dwarfism that affected all my major limbs.
Join Health Talk every Saturday for all your health news.
Yeah, it's more of a validation, you know, it's more of like, okay, you're on it. Because it's been a dream and a goal from the beginning, like, to get here.
The fact that the rest of the world is actually acknowledging the amount of work we put into, you know, into music as Africa as a whole, I think it's fantastic. It's a big one for South Africa, too.
The School of Ballet in Nigeria has changed many a mindset in dance.
Saw it a lot on TV and we looked at it like something that probably could not be taught to us because we thought it was like a white man dance or probably something they just, it's their culture now, but it actually taught me that it's not just about culture because dance is a language.
For more arts and entertainment news, catch Trends every Saturday from 12 to 1.
Young girls crossing our borders often find themselves alone in the big city of Johannesburg.
I came here when my pregnancy was 6 months.
Like many other girls from Zimbabwe, Abigail found her way here to the Central Methodist Church.
My friend who was raped, who was forced to have sex at the church.
I insisted that this needed to be handled with the police.
I think you don't have rights. You do what you don't want to do and you'll be forced.
Any refugee in a strange country is vulnerable to forms of abuse and manipulation.
I don't have an option. I can just continue to put the guys so that I can take care of my baby.
It's 1100 hours here on Newsroom. It's the final hour, Jumbo Africa, if you've just joined us. Now, today we're focusing on a very important story, Renee. It's been running the whole day, and we had lots of interviews with a number of stakeholders coming on board. We focus on President Jacob Zuma, who's established this ministerial task team to assist Bladens on Monday, the Minister of Higher Education and Training, to normalize the situation at institutions of higher learning. Now, Pravin Gordhan, that is the finance minister, is not part of this newly formed task team.
That is quite an interesting outcome for that. But I believe we have some comments, so let's take a look at some.
So we're asking you that question. What solutions do you think the interministerial task team on higher education should come up with? Here are some of your comments. Lizwi says,
give them free, quality and decolonize education. You will see they will stop protesting. She just says, give them what they want and they'll stop.
Vuyo says they should come up with a plan that will resume free learning, be it they begging for donations or halving their salaries. Probably talking to the politicians, half your salaries and beg for donations, and then we can come up with that plan.
Tamsanka says the interministerial task team isn't established for the fee disputes, so there's no need for Pravin Gordhan.
Well, he said the finance minister is not needed in those talks. The man that's supposed to give the money or to make available the money, not needed. So he says. But let's first take a look at your news headlines. We'll come back to some of your comments. Police have fired stun grenades and rubber bullets at protesting students at the Vaal University of Technology.
An intensive search is underway for the awaiting trial prisoner who shot and killed a police officer in the East Rand.
And the man who killed three people at the upmarket Meadows Estate at Moraletta Park, east of Pretoria, is dead. Now those are your headlines, but before we get to the news with Renee, let's find out from Kendall what's happening on the sports front. We've been celebrating all day, Kendall.
Yes, we have. Celebrating Imran Tahir, Rally Rousseau, you know, the biggest heroes that South Africa has got today. Yes, we've got heady news happening with the fees must fall and all the commissions and so on and so forth. But here's something that we can all be happy about. And this is what's coming up in sports.
Got him! Another one!
Imran Tahir's double wicket maiden sparks the blaze that consumes Australia as the Proteas make a clean sweep of the five-match ODI series.
You know our supporters, they want their bragging rights against Pirates and Chiefs. They want the star. I must make sure that the star is there.
Vito Musimane and Mamelodi Sundowns are one step away from continental glory as they prepare to face Egypt's Zamalek in the CAF Champions League this weekend. And in tennis, Serbia's Viktor Troicki causes the upset of the Shanghai Masters tournament, beating Rafael Nadal in straight sets. All of this and more at 11:35. For now, it's back to Renee, who's got the news.
Thank you, Kendall. Now, it's not yet clear whether academic activities will resume at the Tshwane University of Technology. Management says the university will remain open and has appealed to students not to let the academic year go to waste. The appeal follows clashes between police and students. And TUT says it will also tighten security to ensure the safety of its staff, students and property. Now, police have fired stun grenades and rubber bullets at protesting students at the Vaal University of Technology. This follows the arrest of 17 others since yesterday, where a maintenance building and other structures were set on fire. Now, last night, several buildings were damaged, including two that were set alight. The university was also hit by an arson attack a few months ago when offices at residences were set alight by protesting students. The students are demanding an urgent meeting with management to discuss their grievances. No arrests have been made, but police are maintaining a strong presence at the university. Now, earlier this morning, this is what unfolded there.
Students are hurling stones at one of the buildings here in Van der Bijl Park. Students have been in running battles with police since this morning. They're also participating in the Fees Must Fall protests. Now, we heard just a little bit earlier on that today's protest also emanates from the sporadic protests that we've seen since May this year. The university says the institution is opened. And basically what happened was that the university had been on recess and had resumed on Monday. But on Tuesday, students disciplined for a May protest received sanctions. And about 19 students were identified by an investigation by the university into a May protest, which the university says was illegal. And following that, seven student leaders were expelled. So on Tuesday, what essentially happened was that these students were calling for the reinstatement of these seven student leaders. And we saw clashes just a few minutes ago between the police as well as the students, where police had fired rubber bullets as well as stun grenades. And the continuing battle here at the Vaal University of Technology seems to be intensifying. What we also understand is that 17 students were also arrested following the violence that we saw that began yesterday. We understand that they will appear in court tomorrow. We'll just take you through at this stage. You can see there, just in front of us, the students are now picking up more bricks, and they're targeting those bricks at one of the buildings here at the Vaal University of Technology. See students right here in front of us also now wanting to hurl stones at some of the taxis that are passing here. The motorists are also driving past us. There you go. More rubber bullets are being fired. Stay with us live here on SABC News.
Officially, we opened. We are operating. We just have to... It's a pity that we couldn't continue with academic catch-up as planned because of these three-day disruptions. But it's still our intention to engage students. We plan an engagement meeting tomorrow with student organizations because that's what we're left with, to see whether they are countenancing a situation where the academic year could be lost simply because of a few students that are, you know, real leaders in this whole thing. We are having a heavy police presence. We've beefed up our private security services. So we will try and protect. So far, I'm happy that staff, students and property have been protected. We haven't had extensive damage as you have seen in other institutions. But we are not unscathed because, you know, of the little burnings that happened last night.
It seems to be raining over Wits University. This as protesting Wits students say they are ready to meet with management. But the problem is that classes are underway. Also, their demand to meet in the Solomon Mahlangu house will mean that the meeting will only happen around 5 o'clock. That's according to the Wits SRC. Now, the students have agreed to go into the talks with management. This comes after a mass meeting last night. Now, yesterday, police confiscated 6 petrol bombs at the main campus. They are still investigating who planted them. But Wits SRC has since distanced itself from this. And Wits main campus was seen violent protests for weeks, but academic activities resumed this week under heavy police guard. The university has extended its academic program by 2 weeks, with exams set to start early next month. Students are expected to present internal issues, including the removal of private security and police from campuses. Our reporter Makhaketla Motlabe spoke to Wits spokesperson Sharona Patel. And meanwhile, protesting Wits students say they are ready to meet with management today. The students agreed to go into talks with management after a mass meeting last night. Now, the man who killed 3 people at the Upmarket Meadows estate at Moraletta Park, east of Pretoria, has died. His body was found by police who stormed the man's house last night. The names of the 4 deceased have not been released yet. The gunman had earlier freed two police officers and three security guards who he had held hostage. The trouble began when the man reportedly started throwing stones at residents. He then fired shots from his balcony at police and guards who approached his house to negotiate with him. Police spokesperson David Miller says three bodies were found outside the gunman's house.
Members of our special task force, they went through into the suspect's house. They managed to get access into the house itself. During their search of the house, they discovered the body of a deceased male. I can further confirm that outside of the house, we have confirmed that there are three further members of the community that are also deceased. That then has to do with the photo that was circulating in social media. So at this stage, we are in a position to be able to confirm, yes, there were other members of the community that are dead as well.
An intensive search is underway for the awaiting trial prisoner who shot and killed a police officer at the Tembisa Magistrates Court in Ekurhuleni yesterday. Joshua Bomba Shongwane was due to appear in court on 9 hijacking cases when he held up 3 police officers, shooting and killing one of them before escaping.
In these walls that the drama unfolded, leading to the tragic killing of a police officer. Joshua Bomba Shongwane was due to appear in court on 9 counts of car hijacking. The alleged crimes were committed in the Johannesburg areas of Arabi Ridge and Kagiso.
He was coming from the Johannesburg Correctional Services. Whilst he was inside, he held up 3 officers, took the keys. Whilst he was escaping, he shot the officer and he left the keys there. At this stage, we don't know where he is.
Police describe Shongwane as dangerous.
We are appealing to the members of the public that if they see him, they mustn't confront him, but they can phone the nearest police station or they can phone Crime Stop.
Police have sent their condolences to the captain's family and have appealed for information that could lead to Shongwane's arrest.
The KwaZulu-Natal province and the Dube Trade Port in particular has been a hot topic of conversation here at the trade fair in New Delhi. I spoke to the MEC a little bit earlier and I asked him about the Dube Trade Port. But before we get there, let's hear his views on BRICS and the trade fair itself.
I want to start with what you've been doing, but before I start with what you've been doing, you just give me a first sense of your impression of what is happening at the BRICS trade fair.
Well, this is the trade fair where all countries which are part of the BRICS come to exhibit and showcase the investment, but also to present the opportunities that they have. And it is clear that many countries are prepared. You will see from the entrance of this hall and other halls, you will see a number of private sector companies, but you will see also state-owned enterprises displaying their product, but also displaying the opportunities that exist in their respective countries.
Now, you coming today wearing a hat as the representative of KwaZulu-Natal, a beautiful province in South Africa. You've also delivered a presentation, I'm sure, of what the province has to offer. Can you give us a quick little overview of what you presented here?
The first is that KwaZulu-Natal is open for investment. It is the second province in terms of the population after Gauteng, but it is also the one of the fastest growing economies in the country, but it is also linked to number of provinces. You know, if you invest in KwaZulu-Natal, you will be directly linked with Mpumalanga, Limpopo, Gauteng, but also Free State as well as Eastern Cape. We're also directly linked to Swaziland as well as Mozambique. But also, if you locate your business in KwaZulu-Natal, you will then have a free access. You will have a direct access to most of the SADC countries, yeah, as well as Africa as a whole. So KwaZulu-Natal is strategically located, but KwaZulu-Natal is also a very talented and skilled public sector as well as professionals. So if you come to invest in KwaZulu-Natal, you will have skilled people who will be able to get employment but work effectively.
Now, your first port of business was to present the province in a full presentation. What's been the response to what you put forward so far?
Since we presented, the response has been very wonderful, with many people coming from different countries. We've had interaction with a company of which is based here in India, which deals with energy as well as logistics. Were engaging. There's been an interest in that discussion from some companies in Bangladesh, but also some companies in Russia, mostly energy, manufacturing, and logistics.
How do you take the kind of discussions that you're having here with these stakeholders, and how do you land it and then turn it into value?
As we have started with presentation, a number of companies have came to us showing interest. We are then scheduling meetings with them during the day where we'll interact direct and then have one-on-one, package the thinking and project and be able to ensure that we have follow-ups wherein they will then submit their proposals and see how we assist them. And thereafter, we'll be able to help and ensure that those investments take place.
Of course, the trade fair runs here in New Delhi until Friday. Well, what does the rest of your week look like? And then I'm sure you'll be going down to Goa, where you'll be we'll be heading to the BRICS summit itself.
After the trade fair, we are during the day. We've got meetings with various companies. Yeah? Tomorrow we'll participate in the business summit, and afternoon tomorrow. We'll continue with meeting other countries, representatives now of China and representatives of Russia and Brazil. And on Friday, we're going to Goa, where the summit will take place. But one of the most important things we'll be doing there is to sign a memorandum of agreement with a company called Cipla, which is involved in pharmaceutical. And it will be opening a major plant, which will be not servicing only South Africa, but SADC as well as Africa. And it will be opening that company in Dube Trade Port, which is located in KwaZulu-Natal. So we're not just coming to attend only the trade fair and the summit, but we'll also be able to sign a memorandum of agreement with one key investor, who also have conducted a feasibility study and will be directly investing in KwaZulu-Natal.
You touched briefly on the Dube Trade Ports. Just tell us, what is your hopes for this?
Dube Trade Port, together with Richards Bay Industrial Development Zone, are two special economic zones we have in the province of KwaZulu-Natal. Dube Trade Port is just linked to Durban port, which is one of the busiest. It is the busiest port in the Southern Hemisphere. But it is also linked, as it is within the King Shaka International. It is then linked with the cargo terminal. And we are proud that we so far have recorded a zero loss percent for that cargo since it was opened. And it's one of the key cargo for transportation of export goods from the province. But Dube Trade Port on its own, it has vast space for investment. The phase one is complete, is full now. We're moving to phase two. We're also having the third phase where we would be locating companies which want to invest in KwaZulu-Natal.
Well, this is the perfect platform. Thank you for joining us today. Talking to us about what's happening in KwaZulu-Natal. It's the MEC for Economic Development and Tourism in the KwaZulu-Natal province, Mr. Sihle Zikalala.
Just in, unrest has broken out at, or rather, Let's continue with other news of the day. Well, it seems that we're now crossing live to the Fees Commission, where Minister Bladen Zimande is addressing the commission.
Ages. But nevertheless, let me not come to that now. To then say also there are those who do not fall within that category, but who still cannot afford, which then is part of realizing Section 29.1b to say there is this category, what do we do with it, which we have defined as the missing middle. I wish we could get a better phrase for that, by the way. Maybe you will help us, Judge, yes, as the commission, you know. So that is our interpretation. Given the means that are at our disposal and the priorities that actually face our
I would suppose, though, that even if you have somebody who falls outside of the missing middle, if it is a particularly large family, it may be that that family is not, doesn't find education easy to come by, and that in due course, as part of the progression, those people will be covered too.
Judge, I fully agree with you. We've begun to look into this. For instance, as we were dealing with, we will come to this, with the 2017 fee adjustments, we're saying, if we say, for instance, we will assist all those whose families, we are not going to charge the fee adjustments all those who earn up to 50,000 rands per month. What if that family has got more than one student? Obviously, those are some of the things that should be checked, that should be looked at. If you ask my own personal view, if I'm allowed to say that,
yes, of course,
is that actually no one, irrespective of income, should not be able to go somewhere, say, to get a loan, even if I'm earning a million rands per annum, to say, but because I'm building a house or I've got other commitments, I want money to educate my child. There should be a place, ideally, where you should be able to go at the very least to make a loan. And of course, also, if you have such a system, you can even consider charging interest on a sliding scale, depending on the incomes of people who are actually accessing those loans. Well, that would be part of the progressive realization of Section 29.1b, Judge.
And if I may ask you, Minister, we know that the state, through its subsidy system for universities, through either block grant or earmarked grants, that it does fund every student enrolled at a public institution, irrespective of whether that student is rich or poor. It does fund them to a certain extent, to the extent that it either provides block grant funding or earmarked funding to a particular institution. Do you see any nexus between the state funding students indirectly, whether they are rich or poor, and the formulation of Section 29.1b?
Thanks very much, Advocate Pillay. That's a very important issue that we are raising, which, because it's an issue that normally does not surface, that the block grant and earmark grants, well, block grant generally, earmark grants sometimes may select, but generally they focus in supporting particular areas. Government then funds everybody. There is money that government is paying to fund the running of, say, the universities and colleges, which means that government does fund just beyond the poor, whoever is at it is at university. Because then the question that you are raising helps us to say what we are focusing on here are fees, largely. In other words, the family or student contribution. But there is a relationship. There definitely is a relationship. That is why, as we are talking fees, we have just undertaken as a department, through Mr. Ramaphosa, who is the deputy president now, before he was deputy president, a very comprehensive review of the funding formula. for universities. Because we realize that you have to deal with the system as a whole in order to be able to address all the problems. We are at the moment modeling that formula as to how it could apply, although some of the recommendations from there, we have started implementing them, e.g. setting aside some funds for historically disadvantaged universities so that they can use those earmarked funds in order to be able to address issues of quality, some other backlogs, and so on. So I'm not so sure, though, whether you wanted me to say anything more than that, but there definitely is a relationship. Because, for instance, it would be of no use to say now further education is accessible to as many people as possible, but they are accessing education into institutions that are falling apart because they are not being adequately funded. It's a very important issue because also it talks to balancing the priorities that we have as government. Let me just make one last example. One unintended consequence of not having, for having paid the fee increase this year for everybody by government, is that we take money that we had earmarked for masters and PhD scholarships to actually produce the lecturers that we need. For example, South African academics now average age is 55 years, Judge. If we do nothing about it, over the next 10 years we'll be in big difficulties. So that amount of money was meant for training especially young South Africans to become academics in our universities. Unfortunately, that money went with fees must fall. But it talks to the point that we are talking about, that much as we may be looking largely at fees here, but we have to look at the system as a whole. It's funding, in other words.
And if I may then turn to a question on fees for the missing middle. We know that the right, at least as it's articulated in the 1996 Constitution, which is the version of 291B, which you see on the screen now, has been in existence since 1996. And yet the first time we see any concrete measure which addresses the missing middle, who we accept cannot afford university fees, the first time we see such a measure is in 2016. So from that perspective, why did it take that length of time to begin addressing the constitutional rights of the missing middle?
I think that really that had to do with the demand and what government saw as a priority. It's a legitimate question that you are asking, but government thought that we need to rapidly expand access for the poor, which in essence is for the very poor, but who are quite academically capable. That would be my explanation as to why it has taken us so long. And also because of inadequate resources. Even the poor, by the way, were not funding them adequately. What we normally refer to as historic debt that students talk about, we are owing, and NSFA students are owing, has been as a result of the fact that there's been top slicing of NSFAs in many of our institutions. Let me give a concrete example. It's just an example. You have a university that says in terms of its projections we're going to take 1,000 students who will require NSFA support. But because of the demand for access, the university ends up taking 1,300. Yet, it means then it will have to split money meant for 1,000 students now amongst 1,300 students. Which means then these NSFA students we are supporting, they carrying not the full cost of study. They are not being assisted for the full cost of study. And then they start accumulating this other debt, which they are expected to pay, but they cannot pay. That's another problem we've been having for a long time, which we then began to address after the establishment of our department. Because in 2011, DG, if I'm not mistaken, through you, Judge, we paid this kind of debt for NESFA students for 2010, 2011. And then this year, we've paid now for 2013, 2014, 2015, and ensure that for 2016, they don't accumulate this new debt. We fund them fully. So that has been the pressure point, really. That the numbers of poor students who qualified for NESFAS have just been so big that we had not really been able to even cover that fully. So it's a question of competing imperatives. But now the reason why I think the issue of the missing middle has become worse, it's because the 122,000 means has been there for a very long time. And that increasingly some of the students really that we categorize as belonging to the missing middle, they are poor students actually. If you come from a family that is earning 150,000 rand per annum, you can't really afford, say, university or even college fees for that matter. So that would be my explanation as to what is it that has happened. Well, also maybe thanks to Fees Must Fall for actually highlighting this issue and its urgency.
We'll turn in a short while, Minister, to the question of the government's response to the Fees Must Fall movement. But may just finish the questioning on this topic with reference to students who do qualify for NSFAS, who we accept to be the really poor students because they fall within the means test. As you've indicated, the NSFAS allocations to even these very poor students has historically been inadequate and to meet the demand of poor students, and for that reason universities have been top slicing, etc. Does this then mean, Minister, that government has been in breach of its obligations under Section 29(1)(b) in respect of those poor students, because it hasn't been able to fully comply with its obligation to fund those poor students their right to further education?
Judge, I wouldn't put it that way, that government has been in breach. Because also these matters are also based on affordability. They are also based on other very pressing, competing government priorities and how we then slice up the money that is in the fiscus. Right now we are sitting with a challenge of implementing the national health insurance. We've had to build houses as government for the poor. Unprecedented in the world that in 20 years any government has built more than 3 million houses and given them for free to poor people. It hasn't happened in any other country between 1994 and 2014, for instance. Social grants that have played a very crucial role in cushioning the poor from what could have been worse forms of poverty. We are not saying that we are not having poverty. So within that context, therefore, government says, well, this is what we have, this is how far we can go. Because socio-economic rights in the Constitution are very important. I'm not saying that we should underestimate that. Because this issue we are dealing with actually highlights the issue of socio-economic rights. But it's the question of affordability, you know, and ability of government to be able to pay that. I think maybe then we need to ask a broader question, which I hope that the commission judge will be able to ask and provide an answer. Where else is there money in this country that can be able to assist for us to be able to realize Section 29(1)(b) for larger and larger numbers of people who are actually deserving.
And that raises the question of prioritization, Minister, which we will get to in the course of the morning. Perhaps you'd like to move on to your second topic then, Minister.
Yes, thank you very much. I will try not to read everything that is here, but I think that would help. I hope that it doesn't disturb those who are following it there. So I'm on 1.2 now as to what measures we have taken. Firstly, the creation of the new Department of Higher Education and Training was one very important measure taken by government to say, look, one Department of Education too big to be able to deal with the scale of the challenge that face us. So our department then was established in 2009 in order, I would argue, to focus on 29(1)(b) of the Constitution in a much more dedicated way. We also then undertook a very comprehensive process of saying, what is our department supposed to do? And that led to the white paper on post-school education and training, which was published in November 2013 after approval by Cabinet. As I have said, I don't want to repeat, the post-school education and training system is our focus, and we must provide for school leaving youth who are entering higher education or TVET colleges, as well as out-of-school youth who dropped out before grade 9. I will come back to the issue of unemployed youth, because also unemployed youth, insofar as they would like to acquire a skill or some further education, they are our responsibility as well. Our post-school education and training system, I'm sure that the department must have taken you through this. It comprises 26 universities.
Minister, just to assure you that we have had both a presentation by your DG and evidence from functionaries within the department.
So I'll just highlight the measures. Thank you very much. Now, the measures that we've taken thus far in respect to each of the sectors, very briefly. On technical and vocational education and training, I'm not going to tell you about the history, but the most important thing is that if we look at firstly, let me just summarize this. In the creation of our department, the president said, if we are to give adequate attention to this sector, it must fall under our department and become national competence rather than provincial competence, so that it is able to be better aligned with other institutions that are operating at national level, like, for instance, relationship with the university system, the college sector to the university system, and relationship with the sector education and training authority. We've done quite a lot here, which I am sure the department has actually taken through you. We have a very comprehensive turnaround strategy for TVET colleges. Focus being that we would like to make these colleges to be colleges of choice rather than third grade colleges meant for those who can't go to university. Because we believe that most of the skills that are needed by the country can actually be able to be acquired through TVET colleges. As I have said, that is why we have expanded NSFAS such that now just over 50% or around 50% of those who go to TVET colleges do not actually pay tuition fees through NSFAS. And that also, we have more than doubled the intake between 2009 in the enrollments to about from 350,000 to 710,535 in 2015. Those are 2015 figures. But we must say, though, that despite this, the issue of funding for TVET colleges is a big issue for us. Though we are building new campuses, 12 in the most rural area, in rural areas where there's never been a post-school institution, the 12 is still not enough, but it's our kind of focus to begin to say we would like that this kind of mid-level training is available also to youth from the rural areas. Now, I don't know, through you, Judge, if evidence leader would like me to move on to higher education or would like to pause at this stage.
I think I just have one question for you, Minister, on the question of the TVETs. You indicate that approximately 50% of learners within the TVET sector are fully funded through NSFAS, in the sense that they don't pay tuition fees.
No, not fully. Well, they have fully funded tuition fees.
Yes.
But not other needs that they may have. For example, you know the original plan about TVET colleges, even under apartheid, was that at least there should be a campus in every district, which is still our goal as government, as we move forward. And therefore, you'll find that many of these, which were, some of them were technical high schools, never had residential facilities for students or transport facilities for students. So what we then do is that for the students that we pay their tuition fully, some of them, we assist 15% of them, let me put it that way, of those that we assist. We also help them either with accommodation or with transport. But that is far from adequate. So that is why one of the biggest areas that require attention is actually the funding of the TVET colleges.
Now, at present, Minister, we know that the TVET sector attracts the really poor students. Now, in those circumstances, has government applied its mind to how students who do not get fully funded through NSFAS or do not get full funding in the sense that it doesn't cover accommodation, transport, allowances, etc., how those students can obtain funding or access funding?
We have consistently been judge putting bids through Treasury, together, of course, with other departments, highlighting the fact that if government is even serious about achieving many of its goals in the National Development Plan, we won't achieve those unless there is significantly increased funding for TVET colleges. There is that understanding in government. The issue is, how then do we reprioritize such that we are able to get more money? We have in place a system to be able to roll out, to expand, to roll out. You know, we need infrastructure, of course, in a big way to build more campuses. I mean, the demands we have as a department, just about half the mayors in South Africa have called me. I'm not exaggerating, you know. Or if they've not called me, we meet in meetings, you know, in conferences and so on. The Monday, I need a college in my area. There isn't, because just of the demand. The demand is really huge. But that is positive also, because unlike before, people now are beginning to ask for TVET college campuses. Unlike before, that they were seen as just places that are not worth going to.
Just to understand your answer, and I'm really probing what happens to the poor student in a TVET college who does not get full funding through NSFAS. How does that poor student, whose family can't afford to pay fees, how does that poor student access funding to top up what's left over?
Let me say this, that judge and commissioners, we have made a huge difference by extending NSFAS to colleges. Because there was no NSFAS before our department at colleges. Hence also the growth. You know, to double in about 5 years, the numbers actually shows that there's attraction and we are beginning to make the difference. Of course, Advocate Pillay, you are right. The situation is not good for those students who cannot afford. It is not good. I do wish to actually admit that, you know, at TVET colleges. That is why everything possible needs to be done to also expand this. And I was hoping, Judge, I'm hoping that in your work and recommendations, really this must be an area also that needs to be given equal attention, because if we don't do that, we're going to continue unwittingly only funding the university sector at the expense of this sector.
What do you say about the fact that there are 627 private institutions providing college education?
They are filling a gap, Judge. They are really filling a gap. Some of them, they are really filling an important gap and also providing access and offering good quality programs. But at the same time, you really have fly-by-nights that are robbing students. We try to chase them with the police every year. Unfortunately, our criminal justice system seems not to prioritize this as a crime, that people are actually just giving students unregistered programs. As a department, we are making all the effort also to make information accessible and to people say, before you enroll, please check with our department whether that college is not only properly registered, but on whether it is registered for the programs that it is actually offering. So as I say, Judge, some are filling an important gap. Even they offer programs that are not found in public colleges. Of course, some of them are very expensive.
Minister, we've approached the question of funding for TVET colleges from the perspective of the students enrolled at TVET colleges, the poor students enrolled at TVET colleges. Just want to ask you a question from the perspective of the colleges themselves. Now, you've testified that the funding is approximately 80%, they're 80% funded, but in reality that is actually 53% of late. The government hasn't been able to meet the 80% funding limit. Now, we know and we've had before us presentations by the TVET governors, which demonstrates that the colleges have little or no what we understand to be third stream income, or what in a higher education context is third stream income. Now, in those circumstances, how are the colleges expected to make up the shortfall?
Thank you. Firstly, as I have said, we continue to ask for money from the fiscus as the department. We won't stop doing that because we also think that much as third stream income is always important, but if we are to really stabilize and grow the system, we need stable funding from the fiscus, which is quite significant. But there are other initiatives that we have taken. Maybe the DG and the department might have indicated this to you. We've actually tried to bring the sitters closer to the TVET colleges. We think that is very important because when we inherited the SITAs from the Department of Labor in 2010, strictly speaking, we found that a lot of the programs and training programs by the SITAs, more than 90% were offered through private providers. We are not saying private providers do not have a role to play, but it can't be that, you know, you're talking about 8-9 billion rands of training money that is spent exclusively on private providers. We then said to the TVET colleges and the SITAs, come together. SITAs must also help the TVET colleges to develop programs that the SITAs and employers actually need, so that these are offered through the TVET colleges, and in that way TVET colleges are able to access the levy monies to be able to run their other programs. And even some colleges are doing well, others not so well. But that's another way of actually raising third stream income. But the other way of raising third stream income, Judge, is getting TVET colleges to be closer to employers. Because a number of employers themselves have got training and other human resources needs that we know that colleges can offer. So those are some of the ways, but as I say, the balance for us would still be that a larger proportion will need to have to come from the fiscus, so for the mainstream running of the colleges.